Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Len Horowitz, and this is Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse. It's an extraordinary story that actually reveals some divine revelations, codes, Bible codes that have been buried for 3,000 years and its relevance to literally contemporary genocide. Now, that may seem quite different, Bible codes, how they relate to genocide. Well, tonight you'll be in for what will be first a treat in a frightening reality check on where we are with a new phrase we've coined since the publication of the book, Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, called bio-spiritual warfare. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight, bio-spiritual warfare. I want to start, first of all, by reading a section from the 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 14 that really lay the context for what we're going to be doing here tonight. The book Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, when you begin to read that, it begins to read like a New Age fiction novel. And it is nothing like that. In fact, if you're a fundamentalist Christian, you may immediately have some red flags come up for you, and that's perfect. What we're literally doing is challenging you, just like prophecy had said in the final days, you will have to develop a higher level of discrimination and discernment so that you can be guided spiritually to literally make it into the Messianic Age. And that's really what we're doing with the publication of the book Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse. And I want you to know that everything that we're going to be doing tonight and telling you about is in the Bible. Whether it's the Old Testament or the New Testament, it is all prophecy. And that I'd like to direct your attention, first of all, to kind of lay the context of tonight's program from 1 Corinthians, where it says in chapter 12, quote, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestations of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For no one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another the faith of the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the workings of miracles." We're going to be talking about tonight miracles. "To another prophecy, to another discerning of the spirits, and to other different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works in all of these, distributing to each one individually as He wills. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit." Chapter 14 goes on to say, quote, "Even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sounds, how will it be known what is piped or played without that distinction? For it is the trumpet that makes an uncertain sound. Who then will prepare for battle? So likewise you, unless you utter by tongue words easily understood, how will it be known what is spoken? There are, it may be, so many kinds of languages in the world, and none of them is without significance. Therefore, if I do not know the meaning of language, I shall be a foreigner to him who speaks, and he who speaks will be a foreigner to me. Even so you, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, let it be the edification of the church that you seek to excel." And that is really the blessing and the gift of what it is that we're doing here tonight. The edification, that is the enhancement of knowledge within the church at large, all of us who share in the same Spirit that this program is about. Continue in 14. It says, "What is the conclusion then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will also pray with the understanding of what the Spirit is, and I will sing with the Spirit. And I will also sing with the understanding of virtually the sounds and the tones that relay the Spirit. Brethren, do not be children in this understanding. However, in malice be babes. Don't go there. But in understanding be mature. And thus the secrets of his heart are revealed. How is it then, brethren, whenever you come together, each of you has a psalm, has a song, has a teaching, has a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation. Let all things be done for edification. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets, and for God, it is not the author of confusion. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. As in all the churches of the saints, so let peace reign. That's the context in which we're going to hold tonight's program. In fact, if you're a fundamentalist Christian who really loves the King James Version of the Bible, you're going to have some problems tonight. Do not be deceived. In fact, the Bible goes on to explain, particularly in 1 Corinthians, how Christ, beautiful Son of God, Yeshua, came and said, "But you do not know me. You cannot hear me. And my words, my sounds, have no meaning for you because you are virtually blinded in the ways of men. You have your belief and attitudinal barriers up. And if you only knew the truth about who you are and the powerful, magnificent spirit that you have that connects you to God, you would be absolutely incredible. You would perform greater miracles than I." And that's what we're talking about here tonight. We're talking about what it says in the Bible to learn and understand sounds, how it relates to spirit, the knowledge, what God's technology is, so that we can all participate more fully in what is happening right now, which is an extraordinary spiritual renaissance on this planet that no one can stop. So it's actually a celebration. Tonight we're going to do two things. We're going to give you some absolutely wonderful Bible revelations, Bible codes, that have been remained buried for 3,000 years. And in the interpretation and the understanding of those as we are bid to do in the Word, you will begin to see that we are this close to the Messianic Age. We are this close to having 1,000 years of world peace, and that is humanity's destiny. The second part of the program, after intermission, is going to deal with the bad news. You see, we give you the best of the best news right up front. Then we give you the worst of the worst news. And thank God the best of the best is slightly better than the worst of the worst. And we give you the best of the best up front so that you can be empowered to have hope, because that's truly what God wants you to have. And yet the worst of the worst is based on the fact that the forces with whom we do battle, and it is not against flesh and blood, says the Bible. It is spiritual warfare. Again, we coin the phrase biospiritual warfare because in the second part of this program, we're going to be discussing the latest in biologicals and biological weapons that apparently play a major role in biospiritual warfare. And you can imagine that those who held these codes and kept them buried from the masses for 3,000 years and that have used them themselves to coerce and enslave and literally kill millions upon millions of people for virtually centuries, that these people with that knowledge have used these codes to develop new technologies for genocide. And we're going to share with you tonight what they are. In the end, I think you will find that this program is inspiring and revealing of exactly what the gospel tells us is going to occur in the last days. So thank you very much for coming. For those of you who don't know me, my name again is Dr. Len Horowitz, and I'm most famous, or in some circles infamous, for the publication of the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, which because of the grassroots who had the eyes to see the extraordinary documentation in this book, made it a bestseller. It's a best-selling hardcover that you don't see on the New York Times bestseller list, and you will not. It is a best-selling hardcover that the Centers for Disease Control actually tell you is one of the principal books that is behind the anti-vaccine initiatives that the grassroots crusaders out there, my heroes, have used to help edify the congregation, raise and uplift the knowledge of the people. And that the documents, for example, that we delivered were some horrifying documents. Page 427, we, for example, reprinted the United States government contract under which numerous AIDS-like and Ebola-like viruses were bioengineered by the Army's sixth top biological weapons contracting firm called Litton Bionetics, a subsidiary of the mega military weapons contracting firm called Litton Industries, and who is seen on that document as the project officer for the National Cancer Institute overseeing the contract was Dr. Robert Gallo, considered among the world's leading AIDS experts. The fellow who allegedly discovered the AIDS virus for America in 1984 immediately got embroiled in the French-American AIDS fracas with Luc Montagnier. France ended up suing the United States for about a decade. Finally, it was resolved. Around that time, President Clinton pardoned Dr. Robert Gallo. I go in this, and this is my work from the videotape called Emerging Viruses and Vaccinations and some of the audios that people know me through. But you see, what I show you is that not only is Dr. Robert Gallo a fraud, a complete fraud, and I show you the documentation to prove that what he tells us now about the origins of AIDS is false in comparison to what he published and wrote previously. And I show you another document that's related to the Bionetics research contract in that they were all contracts under the largely funded, mostly secret, quote, special virus cancer program that ran from 1962 to the mid-1970s, and that we show you the contract under which the vaccine was prepared, given to gay men in New York City and blacks in Central Africa, that is the 1974 experimental hepatitis B vaccine, prepared in contaminated chimpanzees partly, that according to all the epidemiological evidence, all of the scientific evidence, and inside whistleblower testimony that we actually have on tape recorded, including the director of Merck's pharmaceutical company in charge of developing vaccines, the top vaccine developer, in fact, he's the 1998 Sabin Gold Medal of Honor awardee, Dr. Maurice Hilleman, by President Clinton. The highest esteemed medal in American medicine was given to this man who admitted in an interview that we've just published that he brought the AIDS virus into North America in contaminated monkeys destined for vaccine research and development at Merck in a virtually same scenario, same story as I had laid out in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola based on the scientific evidence and the epidemiology. Now, this story for me is personal as it is for many of you because many of you in this room, in fact, I guarantee you that about 95 or more percent of you in this room have had friends or family who have sustained injury or were killed by the vaccine contaminants, vaccine ingredients, vaccine injuries, or the contaminated blood. That if you study my earlier work, you read the center portion of the book, Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, you realize that there was a cartel, a monopoly over the world's pharmaceutical and chemical industries that included the partners IG Farb and Germany's leading industrial organization. And they, for all practical purposes, was the Third Reich. Their top officials were the top SS. They were the people that pulled Hitler from virtually rags to make him the rich Der Führer, the leader that he became. And their full partners was John D. Rockefeller Standard Oil. There was a complete marriage. And in fact, that word marriage was used in the congressional testimony regarding the relationship between IG Farben and the Rockefeller family, who established a monopoly over American medicine in the 1920s, created the cancer in the industry in the 1920s, and with the help of George Bush's father, Prescott Bush, with the help of the royal family, with the help of political notables like William Draper III, and with the help of the Rockefeller family combined, they created the eugenics movement. We're going to be talking a lot this evening about eugenics. That's defined as the, quote, scientific investigation of genetic differences between the races, including the genetic predispositions for diseases between the races. And that's where virtually the term genocide comes from or is related to. Genocide is simply defined as the mass murder of people for political and or economic reasons. So these people, this century, were the leaders of genocide. They have been behind in funding the major wars, every single war this century. And when you follow their bloodlines back, you realize they and their friends have literally for centuries, and in fact millennia, have been involved in creating unrest. The division of the people. In fact, we call them the sheeple. You know, you divide the sheeple to conquer the flock. You know, and it's part of the same game where you separate rich from poor, black and white, gay from straight, Christian from Muslim, Jew from Gentile, Democrat versus Republican, communist versus socialist versus capitalist. And all the time, it's the same in the background, the same shadow governors we're going to be talking about and exposing tonight. But you see, that's my previous work. And having had a mother who literally scrubbed the streets at Nazi gunpoint in 1938 after the Nazis invaded Vienna and took over my grandparents' clothing store where my mother worked, and then she and her 8-year-old brother were scrubbing the streets at Nazi gunpoint and made it out on virtually the last boat that made it out of Europe. By miracle, I'm here today because of that. That my mother died in 1993 from a vaccine-related injury that, much like many of your friends and family and relatives, have developed one or more vaccine-related injuries. These include, now here's a short list, chronic fatigue, immune dysfunction, fibromyalgia, lupus, MS, ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease, chronic crippling rheumatoid arthritis, adult and juvenile type 1 diabetes, Guillain-Barré, Crohn's disease. And then there's the encephalopathies, the neurological impairments we see typically in our children. Autism, attention deficit, hyperactivity disorders, and sudden infant death. All scientifically linked now to vaccine contaminants, vaccine ingredients, vaccine injuries. And then, of course, besides that, there are the bizarre cancers, leukemia, lymphoma, sarcoma, that were virtually non-existent 50, 60 years ago. If they existed at all, it was very small populations, very small numbers of people. Now we have these in epidemics, largely because of the vaccines. Now, all of that was the work I did earlier in my video, my audio tape called Horowitz on Vaccines, with a videotape called Emerging Viruses and Vaccinations. And as a result of this work, we've had some very wonderful things happen. We've made some major progress because of the support of the grassroots. But you can imagine, if you were living in my shoes, you would feel very uncomfortable about what is going on this planet. And given the fact that I'm a spiritual person, I love God, I believe in the scripture, and I believe in the Bible stories. I felt compelled to pray for this planet and for its people. And I prayed one prayer almost all the time. After having all this revealed to me, my most often prayer was, Lord, show me the Achilles heel of the Illuminati. The Illuminati, if you read many people's work, is about 13 of the wealthiest military, medical, industrialists, and international banksters that have been virtually controlling this planet for centuries. I reflected on the story of David and Goliath, how David, with one small stone properly placed, felled the Hebrews' greatest nemesis. And I said, Lord, please, dear God, show me the Achilles heel. There has got to be an Achilles heel of the Illuminati. Please bless me with that revelation. Now, as I was praying for that, my wife and I decided that we were going to be leaving Massachusetts because it says in the end, in the scripture, that when the great shaking occurs, that's a wake-up. When you see the weather changes, when you see a lot of the social political upheaval, when you see the beasts and the famine and the pestilence. Now, beasts, look in Strong's Concordance, it also includes tiny little beasts, bacteria, viruses associated with the plagues and the pestilence. And then when it says that is apparent, the word to the wise is you move to the mountains. So my wife and I set out looking for the proper survival preparedness homestead. And after about 8 weeks on the road, I had to fly to South Florida. I left my wife off in Spokane. And she was then supposed to go to South Idaho. Instead, she was intuitively guided to northern Idaho. And we ended up, through a series of extraordinary events, synchronicities, many of you know what I'm talking about, some bizarre events, I ended up then knocking on the door of Dr. Joseph Puglio, who was the investigator who had the divine revelations of the Bible codes. Now, interestingly enough, as I was praying my prayer to God, Joey, which is the name he likes to be called, was praying to God also. But his prayer was a little different. You see, Joey had these extraordinary divine revelations, which we're going to talk about today. And because Joey doesn't write too well, he doesn't organize too well, and he doesn't speak too well, he needed to have somebody to organize and write the material up, and he needed to have somebody to convey it. Now, a friend of ours, Errol Owen, who happened to tape me on the Art Bell program one night, and then had given the tape to Joey to listen to, really exposed Joey to my work for the first time. Joey then ordered the book, Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola. He ordered the videotape, Emerging Viruses and Vaccinations, and he viewed them. And after viewing them, he said, Yeshua, his actual endearing name for Jesus is Jeshua. He said, Jeshua, bring me Dr. Len Horowitz. I want to work with Dr. Len Horowitz. That was his prayer at the time that I was praying for the Achilles heel of the Illuminati. Again, because of an extraordinary series of synchronicities, about 2 months later, I ended up knocking on Joey's front door for dinner. And that's where my involvement in the book, Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, began. In fact, Joey shared with me that first night some of these extraordinary revelations. And I felt right away there was something incredible and very important about them. But if you know me, I have an extraordinary busy schedule, and I literally had no time to do this project. He literally laid it on my lap. He says, you have to do it. Yeshua, beloved Yeshua, Jeshua brought you to me. You have to do this work. And I said, Joey, I'm sorry. I'd love to help you, but I can't. I don't have enough time for this. I said, I'll tell you what, after we went through a week or two of this discussion, I said, I'll tell you what, have Errol help you, have our other friend Ingrid Cassell, who's heavily involved in the anti-vaccine and vaccine awareness initiatives, have them help you. And what I'll do is I'll edit the work that they give me. So we tried that. We tried that for about 2 weeks. It went nowhere. Suddenly the entire project literally fell in my lap once again. And I realized it was really important. And so I prayed to God. I said, Lord, if you want me to do this work, then you've got to help me because I don't have the time for this. Now, what's extraordinary is that the book, Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, took me 3 years, 16 hours a day, at least 6 days a week to do. It's about 600 some odd pages. The book, Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, was completed in 5.5 months. It's about the same length. It's not that much shorter. From the time I had that prayer, I had virtually an angel sitting on my shoulder directing me. And that work will become apparent to you tonight. And again, if you're a fundamentalist Christian, when you first read the first chapter of the book and the prologue of the book, you're going to be thinking again, you're reading a New Age fiction novel. And again, I want you to put on your thinking caps and your heightened level of discernment. Because it also says in the Bible that ye shall know them by the fruits of their labor. And what is the fruits of the labor? What is the fruits of Joey's labor that you will know them by? And if you get beyond the first two chapters, if you allow yourself to go beyond the first two chapters, suddenly you will see the fruit. So chapter one is called The Gathering of Eagles. And Joey goes through a series of totally bizarre, kind of like quasi-New Age experiences, kind of like a Celestine prophecy of bizarre events, where suddenly he was guided to go to the Great Northwest to establish a healing center there, where there would be a gathering of people who would be brought for healing this planet in the end times. Now, this is a picture of Dr. Joseph Puglio. That's his real name. For those of you who purchased or read the first limited edition press run of the book Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, you know that we did not use his real name. In fact, I pleaded with Joey, don't use an alias, Joey. You're putting yourself at grave risk if you use an alias. One of the reasons, not a major reason, but one of the reasons why people ask me all the time, how come they haven't shot you yet? One of the reasons is because I'm out in the public all the time. I mean, I would be noticed if I wasn't showing up for my scheduled events. And then you think they want to martyr me? Then they'll make a best-selling hardcover, even greater seller. So I told Joey the same thing. Joey, I said, use your real name. I said, be out in the public. Let people know who and where you are. And he says, no, Len, I don't want that. He says, I have a very busy clinical practice, which he does, and I have a very, very involved family life, and I simply don't want the publicity. He says, please, do it the way I'm telling you. Use Joseph Barber. Use my alias. So I said, okay. So we did it. About three and a half weeks after we published and began distributing the limited edition press run, where you see Joseph Barber on the cover, a white van pulled up at Joey's house one afternoon. It was in the summer, last summer. And it was seen by his mother-in-law and other neighbors. And they cased his property, two men in this white van, and they left. And it came back around twilight, around 9:30 summer night in June. And one of the men got out. He stepped on into some mud, left the track, went onto Joey's property, walked through the woods, stationed himself about 100 yards outside Joey's kitchen window where Joey was at his cook stove. He's an Italian paisan. He loves making spaghetti dinners. And now he's cooking spaghetti dinners at his stove. The window is open. There's no shade drawn. And 100 yards outside, a national security agent parks himself with a laser gun, not a laser-guided gun, a laser gun, and aims at Joey and aims right at his chest and pulls the trigger. And just as he was aiming and beginning to pull the trigger, to show you what that King David's counsel to King Solomon was accurate. I mean, of course, Solomon was about to build the temple, and he was very afraid that he was going to get taken out by the Illuminati. And Solomon counseled him and said, you don't be afraid. And it's the same thing in Psalm 91, where you have 10,000 dying at your left and 1,000 dying at your right. And if you carry the Lord in your heart with no fear, you will march right into the Messianic age. So it was. There was no fear at that time with this man. And because of the thousands of people that pray for people like him and myself for world healing, the angels at the moment that this fellow aimed this gun and fired told Joey that he needed to have more olive oil, cold-pressed olive oil, in a spaghetti sauce. So he raised up this thick glass jar of cold-pressed olive oil, and that beam went directly, dead center, bubbled the outside, heated up the oil, melted the inside, bubbled it, and went attenuated right into Joey's chest. It was still enough to kind of like knock him down. He crawled to the living room. He thought he was having a heart attack. Apparently, that's what they had intended to give him. And through our intelligence sources, our network, we learned through FBI that it was National Security Agency that had placed a contract out on Joey's life. Not so much because he had done the Bible codes from the book of Numbers that we're going to go into tonight, but because his current work involves the decoding of the book of Genesis that he tells me is even more powerful. Now think about it. What does it tell you in Revelation? In the end, that it will be, after the Great Tribulation, the crystal clear waters that we're going to talk about tonight, and related to this work, the crystal clear waters that will once again flow through the rivers and streams, which it says are the people, whose banks will be lined by the tree of life, the olive tree, whose leaves bring about the healing of the nations. The extracts from the olive tree we know is a great immune booster and anti-cancer extract. Isn't it interesting that Joey was saved by the olive tree extract? So it's no accident, in my opinion. So this is Dr. Joseph Pulio is his real name. He decided that after this happened that I was right. And so on the current issues of the book, Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, you will find his true identity, his true name, Dr. Joseph Pulio. So after the gathering of eagles, chapter 2 begins to go into where he is now beginning to be guided to some extraordinary new Bible codes. And for him, it's an extraordinary story. Again, chapter 2, for Christian fundamentalists, you have a difficult time because you don't know if this man is of the devil. It sounds New Agey, hairy-fairy, maybe channeling. But again, in the Bible, it tells you. It tells you in the Bible that in the great end, in the great shaking tribulation, the elderly will dream dreams and have visions, and they will prophesy. And some of the visions that Joey received, some initially even on the windshield of his car, was numbers. And he was driving home one night. He saw a set of numbers come on his dashboard. They were so clear his wife couldn't see them, but they were so clear to Joey. He wrote them down when he got home and began to study them. And he learned that they relate to the ancient Pythagorean mathematics. Now, you remember Pythagoras, Pythagorean mathematics? You remember that supposedly Pythagoras's mathematics was largely lost? Well, Joey's rediscovered a major portion of it. And that in the Pythagorean mathematics, and Joey realized mathematics is God's language. You can't lie with math. One and one is always two, unless you're a manipulator. And in Pythagorean mathematics, Joey learned that there are only nine numbers in God's universe, 1 through 9. 10 is actually 1 plus 0, which is 1 in Pythagorean mathematics. 11 is 1 plus 1, that's 2. 12 is 1 plus 2, that's 3. And so what Joey realized is that the ancient languages, which originally expressed God's divine essence, as we'll talk more about in a couple minutes, were actually mathematics-based. And that there is an alphanumeric relationship, a letter-number relationship in all the languages. And that, for example, the English language, Joey learned, that if you take 1 through 9, and that's A through I, and then it starts over again at 1 through 9, J through R, and then S through Z is, again, 1 through 8. So it goes 1 through 9, 1 through 9, 1 through 8, that this is the alphanumeric translation of English, and it's correlated, actually, to Hebrew. Now, you remember, Hebrew is, instead of English reading left to right, Hebrew is read backwards from, or correctly, from right to left. Of course, Hebrew preceded English. And that we know, all the authorities know, that Hebrew and Sanskrit are far more spiritual languages. And I'm going to show you some information in a minute to additionally support that. But the language itself had mathematical derivatives and origins. And so Joey then, through a series of numbers, began to realize that there's like some perfection that's expressed in the Pythagorean mathematics that we don't typically think about. For example, he began to do multiples. For example, here you see the multiples of threes, where 1 times 3 equals 3, 2 times 3 equals 6, 3 times 3 equals 9, then 4 times 3 equals 12, where 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 times 5 equals 15, where 1 plus 5 is 6, 3 times 6 equals 18, where 1 plus 8 is 9. And suddenly you see that you have a repeating code of 3, 6, 9, 3, 6, 9, 3, 6, 9, 3, 6, 9, 3, 6, 9 throughout the multiples of 3s. And Joey reflected on his research of the great work of Nikola Tesla. This century's greatest scientist, greatest mind, was not Einstein. It was Nikola Tesla, the genius in electrotherapies, electrotechnologies. Ultimately, his work was translated in medicine by Royal Raymond Rife and another fellow by the name of Keeley, who was a student of Tesla. And it was Keeley, Joey reflected on, that said, if humanity only knew the power of the 3s, 6s, and 9s, it would be a completely different world. And so he saw that, and then he did the multiples of 6s, and there again there was a relationship. 1 times 6 equals 6, 2 times 6 equals 12, where 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 times 6 equals 18, where 1 plus 8 is 9, 4 times 6 equals 24, where 2 plus 4 is 6, 5 times 6 equals 30, 3 plus 0 is 3, 6 times 6 equals 36, where 3 plus 6 is 9. Again, you see now 639, 639, 639, 639 becomes the pattern. And when he did this for the multiples of 9s, 1 times 9 equals 9, 2 times 9 equals 18, where 1 plus 8 equals 9, 3 times 9 equals 27, where 2 plus 7 equals 9, 4 times 9 equals 36, where 3 plus 6 is 9, suddenly you realize that in the multiples of 9s, it always ends up 9. 9 is completion. 9 is the last number. That is God's last number. And then Joey began to study the multiples of eights. And he realized that 1 times 8 equals 8, 2 times 8 equals 16, where 1 plus 6 equals 7, 3 times 8 equals 24, where 2 plus 4 is 6, 4 times 8 equals 32, where 3 plus 2 is 5. Suddenly he realized he was looking at 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, which was the English language backwards. The alphanumerics were the English language backwards. And that when he added the English language backwards to the English language forwards, 8 plus 1 is 9, 7 plus 2 is 9, 6 plus 3 is 9, you always got 9 completion. So there was a code instilled in the English language by the people who created the English language based on the mathematics. And in fact, it relates to the Tower of Babel. Initially, God created the dialects. But what happened subsequent to that, through the use of that model, was the realization by the induction of the dialects, and we're going to talk more tonight about dialects, was the division of the sheeple so that the flock could be more easily conquered. As soon as you introduce the dialects, then people spoke in foreign tongues. They couldn't understand one another. You had the loss of the edification of the congregation. And instead of love and trust, you had hate and fear take its place. And instead of speaking in a language such as Hebrew, wherein the tones of the spoken word actually reflect a spiritual essence. The sound delivers spirit. Of course, you remember that in the beginning, there was God and the Word and nothing else. And God spoke the universe into existence in 6 days. We're going to talk more about the number 6 and why that's relevant. 6 days. He spoke it. And the word was what? Sound. And sound is what? Electromagnetic frequency, vibrations. The sound of my voice you're hearing right now is being perceived because it's an electromagnetic waveform that's coming into your ears and you're perceiving it. Radio signals, television signals, sun, light, color, all electromagnetic frequencies. That's God's technology. This Hebrew language relays the spirit. So now, you not only when you take that language and invert it or corrupt it and create dialects, you not only confuse people's communications and instill distrust and hate, substituting for fear and love, at the same time you separate man from God. This fellow, his name is David John Oates. He's famous or infamous. He was involved in a problem with a famous talk show host, Art Bell, for a while. I understand recently they resolved their differences. But this fellow is famous for what's called reverse speech. Now, my master's in public health is in behavioral science from Harvard. And when I heard this man first relay his thesis, which stated that English speech played backwards relays the truth of the soul, I was interested. I was, in fact, so interested, I ultimately paid him some money to do an experiment for me so that I can analyze the credibility of what he was saying in his thesis. And I found it to be extraordinary. Now, you think about this for a minute. The English language is related mathematically, came derived mathematically from the ancient languages, and that to the extent now, let's say you were the Illuminati. Let's say you had intended to create dialects to divide the sheeple to conquer the flock. Let's say that you had the awareness that the power of God and love of God was inherent in the language, the original tones, and you had a desire to share an alternate, a substitute, a fraudulent language with the public so that they couldn't know their spiritual divinity, their connection. Would you ever want to lose the original code? No. Because you would always want to go back and retrieve it, now wouldn't you? For your own secret societies, secret orders. But the fact that suddenly we read English from left to right, in essence, what my conclusion is based on David John Oates' work, is that when we speak English, we are actually having the truth of the soul being suppressed. And inside you is a spiritual being screaming to be heard and acknowledged and loved and to celebrate that connection to God. And so that's why when David John Oates, for example, plays a Clinton speech backwards, you'll hear Clinton say something to the effect, "I'm nothing but a cheap snake oil salesman." And that type of thing is very clearly evident in the reverse speech. And it makes total sense given these revelations. Now again, to show you that form follows electromagnetics. This is a picture of my daughter Elena. One day last winter, she was in the back of our house. This is the lake, Ponderay, in back of our house in northern Idaho. And one day she came up to me. She said, "Daddy, Daddy, come look. The lake is full of crystals." And I looked out the window. It looked like snow. But I went down there and I looked, "My Lord, look at this. It's all crystals." And I looked, examined them closely, and they were all these beautiful crystals. They were in the shape, almost all of them, of leaves. And they were all stretching to the southwestern sky as though they were following the sun or had somehow vibed to the sun's rays, the electromagnetics. And they had suddenly come out, spontaneous creation, out of the lake. It hadn't snowed that night. It wasn't windy at all. Something happened overnight that suddenly grew these crystals directly from virtually a placid lake. And then I began to get involved in investigating the science of cymatics. Cymatics is the science of the effect of sound, electromagnetics, on matter. And it was pioneered by a fellow by the name of Hans Jenny. And to share with you and give you a little bit more appreciation of the powerful influence of sound on matter and, in fact, creationism. See, because don't forget, we in medicine and physiology, we learned that form follows function, didn't we? Form follows function. Well, as you saw in the slide here, here's a form that has virtually no function that we're aware of. And it came from nothing. It's spontaneously generated. So when you study cymatics, you'll learn, as I'm going to show you now, by playing a couple of videotapes. The first is probably the world's leading expert in creationism, the science of creationism, that is. He's a world's leading scientist. His name is Dr. Carl Bau. And he is speaking here in the videotape I'm about to show you, with Minister Kenneth Copeland. And you'll hear him discussing the powerful effect of sound on matter and creation of this planet. And then I'm going to switch to probably Europe's top scientist in the field of cymatics. His name is Dr. Peter Sergei Manners. And I think that you'll find what they have to share very interesting. Can I please have the first video?
Now, what your audience is now viewing is an internal structure of the Earth, dimensionalized, and I'll talk more about that when we talk about the flood in a short while. But in brief, remember that we had before the flood, from day number two until the time of the flood, this canopy above the earth, this crystalline canopy above the earth. In the last broadcast, we talked about some dimensions of that. This would have kept the atmospheric pressure in place, would have kept the electromagnetic field recharged, and also it would have picked up the signals from space, the sun, the moon, the stars. We would have been able to see them. By the way, I didn't mention on the last broadcast, before the flood, you could see the stars in full color. Do you know the stars are in color? We miss so much today. Because of the physical nature of this firmament, you can see the stars in full color. And because it was essentially a crystal radio receiver, you could pick up the signals that those stars give off, and much of that is synchronized into what we call music.
Well, you know, our eyes don't view but just a little portion of the color spectrum that goes way out like this. And I've seen models, being a musician all my life, I've seen models of that color spectrum, and music is in the color spectrum.
Oh, yes, it is.
And Phil Driscoll, the greatest horn player.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Can we have the next one, which is, again, Dr. Sir Peter Guy Manners?
You can see all this and watch it before your eyes. But everything owes its existence solely and completely to sound. Sound is the factor which holds it together. Sound is the basis of form and shape. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. We are told that this is how the world began and how creation took shape. If we put that into the modern idiom and say that into the great voids of space came a sound and matter took shape, please watch carefully.
We can also use different shapes of plate. Here we have a triangular plate with a crystal attached to its underside and produce a sonorous figure. We change to a higher note and see a rather more complicated figure.
Okay, thank you. Now, the next video segment that I'd like to play, I'd like to introduce to you with a little preface. Again, reflecting on the fact that we've all been divided virtually by sheep, like sheeple, we've all had all of our religions and all of our organizations infiltrated. The fellow that I'm about to share with you is somebody who has been very, very well demonized. You see, I'm like Daniel. I love going into lion's dens, and I will take my message anywhere to any audience that invites me. One of the audiences that have routinely invited me since the beginning of my work is the Nation of Islam. Now, again, that's pretty interesting. From somebody who is Jewish by tradition and loves the Jewish people and loves my Jewish heritage, and yet I'm also a Messianic Jew, so I accepted Lord Jesus Christ into my heart and soul. And so many of the Christians tell me that that is indicative of I'm a completed, they call me a completed Jew. To my Jewish colleagues, I am a traitor. But when I mentioned to my Christian colleagues that I typically go to Nation of Islam events and that I personally had an invitation to have dinner with Minister Louis Farrakhan, and in fact it was the Nation of Islam, which was the first organization in the world based on my research, to put a moratorium and recommend a moratorium on all U.S. government promulgated vaccines, because they saw and knew the truth. Suddenly, my Christian friends say, stay away from me. I don't want to have anything to do with you. He's satanic. And when I say that to my Jewish friends, that I am on, you know, personal terms with the Minister of Health of the Nation of Islam and Louis Farrakhan, it's right away, what are you, anti-Semitic? But I want you to know that in my dealings with Louis Farrakhan, I found him to have expressed some absolutely divine comments. And what I'd like to share with you now is his position regarding the powerful effect of sound on each and every single one of us and how it reflects to 1 Corinthians verses that I read when we began. Listen to this.
And just as every note has a different vibration, every human being vibrates differently. As you notice, when these musicians were warming up, it sounded like chaos. But when the concertmaster came out to prepare the way for the conductor, he signaled to the oboe And that wonderful reed instrument gave the A that they all tune up by. And A, I think, is 440 vibrations. Now, after they all tuned up, they were ready for the conductor. Now, the conductor's job is to know the score of everything that was played tonight and to interpret that score that the soul of that person who wrote the song will live through him and through the wonderful musicians who play under his baton. Human beings are like this. Different shapes, different colors, different sizes, different vibrations. But what the world needs now is a composer. A divine composer who can put human beings together on the staff of life so that we don't vibrate creating dissonance and discord, but vibrate creating harmony and unity and peace.
Thank you.
That is the lesson.
That indeed is the lesson. The speech was given after Minister Farrakhan played the symphony, Mendelssohn's symphony, of the fabulous Jewish composer, expressing the soul of Mendelssohn, was one of his life's treasures. And so it is that we see that who we are as human beings literally are the manifestation of sound and electromagnetic frequencies. Here in some additional slides, you see that so is the earth, the manifestation of sounds. What you're seeing coming literally out of formless substance are forms that look like planets and solar systems directly as a result of various sounds. Here is a geometric form from water and soap bubble coming up out of the water from sound. Here is a hexagonal shape, six-sided hexagonal shape from sound. That relates to the six-sided hexagonal shapes of many cells. Here you have form created through sound that looks virtually identical to what cells under a microscope look like, with nuclei-like structures and cell membranes. Here you have another one. Here you have God's most perfect water molecule. You're looking at what the water looked like on this planet thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. This is a section under an electron microscope with a 20,000 magnification from a sample taken from 2 miles beneath the polar ice cap. Notice that it has a six-sided hexagonal shape ring structure to it, and the outside of this is crystals. This is what Revelation speaks about when, again, after the Great Tribulation, the crystal clear waters will once again flow through the rivers and streams, through the people. Sound dramatically creates and affects structures of water in particular. Memories of sound can be held in water like this. Now, there is the Professor Willie Apple, who is probably the principal expert in the field of Gregorian chants, and that Professor Willie Apple's work was studied by Joey in his search for the truth about language and numbers and codes and music. And he found Apple's work, Apple, a great critic of the Roman Catholic Church. He's very upset with the Roman Catholic Church that they not only lost some 150-some-odd Gregorian chants, some of the holiest, most spiritually uplifting hymns of all time, but he was upset that they lost the ancient hymn to St. John the Baptist. that according to most authorities was the most powerful, uplifting spiritual hymn ever sung. And that he relayed through his work to Joey that this hymn was sung through six tones, according to the ancient musical scale called the solfeggio scale. And Joey reflected on that. And he reflected on his research in sound and the six-sided hexagonal shape, clustering of water. Joey had been involved in the development of these types of clustered waters. In fact, in this audience, there's a couple people who are actually also involved in researching and developing this type of clustered water technology. In fact, this, when you study this shape, the divine structure, not only, in fact, did the astronomers of the world realize that the planets in the solar system are clustered according to the six-side hexagonal shape, much like you see bees creating the honeycomb, the same thing. But there's a Dr. Lee Lorenzen, who I'm currently working very closely with, who is the authority on clustered water, who studied the healing wells of the world, about 11 of them, Lourdes, France, Karamisu, Japan, and found that the common denominator among all the healing wells of the world was the fact that they all maintained this same six-sided cluster shape. Now, Willie Apple, Professor Apple, he was telling Joey through his work that this number six is an important number for music and sound, and that there was an ancient musical scale called the solfeggio that relayed the six most sacred divine electromagnetic frequencies of sound. And Joey began a search for the secret ear and the knowledge about that. In fact, Willie Apple said that there was a secret ear that Beethoven used as a deaf man to hear the music. And Joey learned that Beethoven, actually, who had very, very good intimate friends who were in the Freemasons, who everyone knows, Beethoven, who studies Beethoven, that he used the Bible for inspiration. But what it occurred to Joey was that Beethoven was actually using the codes within the Bible for that inspiration as a deaf person. And subsequently, the greatest composers that followed Beethoven, including Haydn, whose work called The Miracle, his 96th symphony that you heard when you made your way into this auditorium tonight or at the beginning of this video. Haydn's 96th symphony is called The Miracle, and we'll explain why in a couple minutes. But using Pythagorean mathematics, 9 plus 6 is 15, 1 plus 5 is 6, the number 6. And Willie Apple said that there was a hymn called St. John the Baptist, and then there was a poem that he relayed to Joey, which said, quote, "Sweeter sounds than music knows. Charm me in Emmanuel's name, for all her hopes my spirit owes to his birth and cross and shame." That music and spirituality was intimately connected, and Joey began to search for the truth about music and the ancient musical scale, the solfeggio, that was hidden. And in this search, he began again going through the Bible. And when he searched through Psalms 120 through 134, he found that there were these songs of degrees. Song of degree of David, song of degrees of Solomon, and just songs of degrees. And when he laid it out, it looked to him like it was a musical scale. It was like an octaves. And that he began then to pray to his beloved Yeshua. His beloved, he called him Jeshua. Because he felt that he was getting close. But his prayer was intense. He said, "Please, Jeshua, show me my next step." And then one night, Joey was sleeping, or so he thought. And in the middle of a dream, he thought, his beloved Jeshua came to him, to his bedside, in front of his bed. And next to Jeshua was a huge angel. And the angel held a Bible. And the Bible, the face of it was covered with all fuzz. And smiling, Yeshua and the angel said to Joey, "We've come, brother, for your work. and we want to help you, but you've got to answer some questions before we can help you. So they asked Joey a few very, very simple questions, and each time he answered a question correctly, a little bit of the fuzz over the Bible started to clear. So Joey says, wait a minute, is this really happening to me? Am I dreaming or am I awake? So to test, he opened his eyes, and his beloved Jeshua and the angel were still there. So he closes his eyes, and they were still there. It didn't matter. So he answered the final few questions that the angel asked him correctly. And suddenly all the haze in the Bible cleared, and he was instructed directly into the book of Numbers, chapter 7, verses 12 through 83, wherein the codes that we reveal lie. Codes that are literally created, that are literally related to creation, destruction, and miracles. Joey was first led to chapter 7, verse 12, because that was the first day. The first day or the first tome. And that if you look at the book of Numbers, chapter 7, verse 12, where it says, quote, and he offered for his offering the first day was Nahshon, the son of Amminadab of the tribe of Judah. And you count six verses down from there. You suddenly see the second day. Six verses down from there, you see the third day. Six verses down from there, you see the fourth day. And again, fifth and sixth are six verses down. And then when you read between those first, second, third, fourth, and sixth day, the verses, you begin to become startled. Let me read you verse 13. It says, quote, and his offering was one silver charger, the weight thereof was 130 shekels, one silver bowl of 70 shekels, after the shekel of the sanctuary. Both of them were full of fine flour mingled with oil for a meat offering, end quote. Did you get that? What was that? I didn't quite get that. Let me just read that again. Both of them were full of fine flour mingled with oil for a meat offering? Well, that just doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense now. It won't make any sense in the future. And even if you take into consideration that King James and others who wrote subsequent Bibles from the Torah translations changed certain words, and the meat was originally field or grain or meal offering, it still doesn't make a great deal of sense or relevance. In a magnificent, inspired book, where God doesn't pull any punches, he tells you straight out what his laws are. He gives you stories to exemplify the laws. He tells you, if you don't follow these laws, you sin, you're going to have some problems. Suddenly you read this, and that's not the problem. The problem is that six verses down from verse 13, the same verse appears. That is, 13 plus 6 is 19, 19 verse reads as follows, quote, he offered for his offering one silver charger, the weight thereof was 130 shekels, one silver bowl of 70 shekels after the shekel of the sanctuary. Both of them were full of fine flour mingled with oil for a meat offering, end quote. Six verses down from there, it repeats. Six verses down from there, it repeats again. Six verses down from there, in fact, throughout the entire chapter 7 of the book of Numbers, that verse repeats every six verses. How about verse 14, the next verse? Quote, one spoon of 10 shekels of gold full of incense, end quote. Well, it doesn't make too much sense, but look, six verses down from 14 is verse 20. One spoon of gold of 10 shekels full of incense. Six verses down from there, one golden spoon of 10 shekels full of incense. Same thing, repeats. In fact, when you read the chapter 7 of the book of Numbers, in fact, you see exactly what I'm saying to you is true. Here you see that Joey began to realize that there was something sacred about these numbers. And when he began to use the Pythagorean mathematics on them, For example, verse 12 is 1 plus 2 is 3. Six verses down, that was the first day. Down from verse 12 is verse 18, the second day. 8 plus 1 is 9. Six verses down from there is 24, the third day. 2 plus 4 is 6. 396 goes throughout the chapter. Suddenly, Joey realized that that was likely the first tone of the ancient musical scale of the solfeggio. Chapter 13, verse 13, 3 plus 1 is 4. Six verses down, when that verse that I just spoke reappears, is 19. 9 plus 1 is 10. 1 plus 0 is 1. Six verses down is verse 25. It repeats again. 2 plus 5 is 7. 417 repeats throughout the entire chapter. The third verse down, which I also read, verse 14, 4 plus 1 is 5, where that repeats again, is verse 20. 2 plus 0 is 2. Verse 26, 2 plus 6 is 8. 26 and 6 is 32. Verse 32, 3 plus 2 is 5. You see throughout, the third tone is 5 to 8. Suddenly Joey realized that he had, in the book of Numbers, the six musical tones of the ancient musical scale called the solfeggio scale. And he went into the Apocrypha. Now we're told that the Apocrypha is not really a good part of the Bible. But yet when you look in Webster's dictionary, in fact, it is listed as a legitimate book of the Bible, the Protestant Apocrypha. And therein, Joey found the leads to get the truth about the ancient musical scale, the solfeggio, as well as the hymn to St. John the Baptist. Now, not only was the language changed, everything was changed. You begin to realize that the Illuminati, the shadow governors, our masters, our worldly masters, began to manipulate everything from the colors on the glass that were adorning the churches to the wristwatches, the faces of our clocks, which literally is backwards. Of course, it tells you in the Bible that the first hour of the day is 6 p.m. We have at the top 12. Everything is inverted. Virtually everything is inverted or manipulated or changed, distorted just enough so it would prohibit us from having the electromagnetic and or spiritual elevating effects. And with regard to the ancient musical scale, here you see in figure 2.5 in chapter 2, the original solfeggio had these six tones, ut, quint, laxus, re, mi, fa, sol, la. Today we have do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, thanks to the Sound of Music. And so there's seven tones in today's musical scale, and there used to be six. Now, Joey began to try to find the meanings of these notes because he felt that there has got to be some important meaning in them. And in addition, he began to lay out the numbers as a mathematician or a physicist might look at this. And when you do that, ut, 396, re, 417, mi, 528, fa, sol, la, the rest, you see that there's something extraordinary going on here, folks. Look at the way the numbers go according to the Pythagorean mathematics. Watch. Look at the hundreds column. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The tens column. 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The singles column. 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 2. And then when you run the mathematics again, the Pythagorean mathematics, reducing these triple-digit integers to a single-digit integer, suddenly you see 936 again. Keeley's research of humanity only knew the power of the three sixes and nines. So he realized that there was something really interesting going along about these notes and tones, and we had some physicists begin to look at these, and they say, oh, boy, these are extraordinary. They're harmonics. And not only are they harmonics, but they relate to an extraordinary number of 144,000. All of those notes, as we'll talk about in a couple minutes, relate to 144,000. Now, chapter 3, before I share that, the good news, the best news with you, chapter 3 goes into an expose on King James, the Bible, and the secret societies. Sure, it was the ancient Levi priests who translated the original Torah into the Greek Septuagint some 3,000 years ago that originally placed those verse numbers and those codes in the Bible. No doubt about it. The academic debate for Christians and those who would like to debate the issues, the scholars, will have to decide, given the fact that Moses was inspired as he was, and the verse numbers that I just, and the verses that I just read you, are in the Torah. They are in the original Torah. That they repeat like that in the original Torah, that was not placed in there by man. The verse numbers were placed in there by man. And then again, our thesis is that these are God's tones, God's codes, God's technology placed in there by the ancient Levi priests. When they began to get involved in occult, in mysticism, in Kabbalah, and black magic, that's when they began to play with these codes and bury them from the masses, at least from our research. And so the academic debate question comes where you see that every six verses in the Torah, the inspired book of Numbers, those verses repeat. You'd have to advance the thesis that Moses knew ahead of time to put those in there because God instilled in Moses the knowledge that at some point it would be necessary. And just like God, we are his children. Likewise, you don't always share with your children facts, knowledge, before they're mature enough to deal with it. Isn't that right? So that's the academic debate, and it's purely an academic debate. I personally don't even need to get involved in it. For me, I'm satisfied to know that these codes exist and what their meanings are, particularly at this extraordinary time as it is related to the edification of the congregation. But chapter 3 goes into King James, because King James and his boys knew all about these codes. In fact, King James was the highest Knights Templar. He was not only King of England and King of Scotland, the first king to assume those titles simultaneously, but he also was the highest level Knights Templar. That's the Freemasons, the highest level Mason. And that it was the Templars who stole this ancient arcana, the ancient knowledge, the sacred knowledge, according to historians, from the Holy Land. Buried, some say, it was below King Solomon's temple in the Holy Land. And according to some historians, they buried some of it in southern France, and others say that it's buried mostly today under the new Solomon's temple in Scotland. The Scottish Rite Freemasons, that's where their center is. Of course, London, according to most Illuminati investigators, is the center of the Illuminati for the financial aspects. But we get into chapter 3 in a very interesting and very controversial background check and reality check on King James and his boys, that those Christians who love the King James version of the Bible, which according to many, many wonderful Christians, authorities, ministers, pastors, is an anti-Semitic text, and that there are better, more reputable texts. Personally, my Bible that I like reading is called the Complete Jewish Bible. It's for Messianic Jews. Covers the Old and New Testaments beautifully. Very close translation to the original Torah and the original scriptures. And according to others, my particular minister, my pastor, is Pastor Norman Franz, who is probably one of the world's leading experts in modern-day prophets and training for prophets. And his favorite Bible, I believe, is the New American Standard. And he admits on a new audio package that we just produced called Bible Challenges in the Last Days, he basically says straight out that the King James Version of the Bible is anti-Semitic. Now, in this end times, when we're coming back together again, and by the end of this program, I hope you see that indeed, Jews and Christians are the same. They are one. And as one, and in fact, background check on that. The fact of the matter is that the vast majority of Jews who walked the planet at the time of Christ, particularly the scholars, the spiritually endowed, the Levite priests, all herald Christ as the Messiah. Now, how come it is suddenly that in the Jewish tradition, you don't have that acknowledgement? Well, it seems to boil down to in the era of Constantine, about 100 years after Christ's death, suddenly, for political reasons, the Jews and the Christians began to become separated, divided like sheeple. But before Christianity, there was all Jews. And of course, you know, Christians, we received the blood covenant. The Jews received first covenant, and the Christians received the blood covenant, the sacrifice. So the background check is, it's time to bring it all together again and no longer be deceived. So the secret societies play a major role. We go through in the chapter of the Grand Masters of the Pre-Edition, way back from 1188 on down through the 1900s, and you see some extraordinarily famous names who were the head of the Illuminati or the head of the Freemasons. People like Leonardo da Vinci, Robert Flood, Isaac Newton, Sir Isaac Newton, Victor Hugo. Very interesting that these leaders of their time were also the highest level Freemasons. And when you look back at the ancient manuscripts of the Templars, here's their constitution, you begin to see some very familiar things like snakes and the Star of David, which is the six-sided hexagonal structure when you draw lines between the points. And then at the very center here of the Freemason, of course, here it is, a synopsis of degrees or songs of degrees, where you see it right between the head of the snake and the tail of the snake is a Nazi swastika. You find some very, very interesting things and in how it relates to contemporary propaganda. Here again, genetics, eugenics, the snake of the gene. In time, the future of medicine. And you begin to read, as we explain, how incredibly infiltrated modern media is, the mainstream media is, by the Illuminati. In fact, we draw largely upon the work of great work of Dr. John Coleman in his Conspirators' Hierarchy, The Story of the Committee of 300, and show you how virtually the 13 families of the Illuminati control a committee of a 300, which then controls a variety of other social, political, and economic structures, as well as religious structures through their networks. Ultimately, way down at the bottom, underneath the British Secret Service, MI6, the CIA, Mossad, the Royal Institute for International Affairs and Petroleum and Mining and Industry and Religious Organizations, One World Government Church, where way down here you see the Bilderbergers and the Trilateral Commissions and the Council of Foreign Relations, which controls the United States government. Council of Foreign Relations, for those who don't know, is about 3,000 of the world's wealthiest military, medical, industrialists and international banksters, if you will. And that they control the United States government, they, in fact, pull the political strings and the puppet politicians that they give us a chance to vote for in this thing they call democracy that's actually corporate fascism masquerading. And that the media plays a major role to perpetuate the hoax, the disinformation. And so chapter 4 goes into a royal expose on the media. And we relate it to not only the Bible codes, but the protocols of the Elders of Sion. Now, the protocols of the Elders of Sion is known or as infamous for being the most anti-Semitic text in the world. If you mention it in any program in the media, virtually you're immediately labeled an anti-Semite. And you're harshly criticized by Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith or Southern Poverty Law as anti-Semites. Well, you know what? I'm Jewish, although Jews say I'm a traitor. I'm telling you I'm Jewish. And when I went to college, I took a course in racism and anti-Semitism. And you know what they taught us there? They taught us to read anti-Semitic literature so that we would know what it reads like. Read racist literature so you know what it reads like. And when you begin then to read a document that everybody tells you, don't read, you realize that the reason why they're telling you not to read it, because it lays out virtually the program for the New World Order. Particularly revealing is its references to the use of the media. In this chapter, we go into Michael Drosnin, who wrote the book, the best-selling book called The Bible Code, according to the New York Times, which along with the Washington Post, is a virtual mouthpiece for the Central Intelligence Agency and the British Secret Service. Michael Drosnin advanced the thesis that there were these equally distant letter sequences that were in the Bible that you needed a computer to see that revealed extraordinary things and even prophecy, perhaps. Now, excuse me, are you trying to tell me that God's word would be kept from the computer illiterate? That you need to have a machine that wasn't invented back then to really understand Bible prophecy? I don't believe it. So we go into great depth in showing you that Michael Drosnin most likely is a counterintelligence propagandist, much like Richard Preston was when I exposed him in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola. He's the fellow who wrote the book The Hot Zone. Complete counterintelligence propaganda. In other words, because these are people involved in the occult, the secret societies, they're into black magic and mysticism. And what do they use? The magician's sleight of hand routine sometimes. They say, look over here, look over here. Look at the Bible codes. Look at the equally distant letter sequences. Okay? And while you're looking over there, you're missing the real codes over here. Or with Richard Preston with the Hot Zone, as I showed you in Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, he says, look over here at Kinnam Cave, this deep, dark cave in Central Africa. Look it over here. Look over here. Kinnam Cave. Kinnam Cave. That's where the viruses, Ebola, emerged from. And meanwhile, what's over here, a couple hundred kilometers from Kinnam Cave, is Litton Bionetics Research Laboratory, where they were creating those types of viruses. So we expose Michael Drosnin's work in the Bible Code as being disinformation. We expose his National Security Agency connections, and we expose why his work was used as a counterintelligence propaganda piece. Del Washburn's book, The Original Bible Code, comes closer to the thesis that we're advancing with regard to sound. Because when you study his work, you see that there are these, like, clusters. There are these clusters. And that there's, he talks about vibrations. And or he uses some analogies that relate somewhat to our work. But they are not close enough, and we're concerned about that. And then we show you who in the media is behind this barrage of counterintelligence propaganda. We go through, for example, the Council of Foreign Relations members in the media. Everything from the people who are involved in the American Spectator, member Gene Kirkpatrick, to Dow Jones and Company members, to the Dallas Morning News, to Newsweek. Oh, look at all the people in Newsweek. And then, of course, Time magazine. Look at all the people on Time magazine that are involved, members of the Council of Foreign Relations. These are the inside players, and that's why you read what you read. It is all part of a blinding agenda that relates directly back to the protocols of the Elders of Sion. When authorities researched this text, the most recent reputable authorities, when they researched this text, it did not originate as an anti-Semitic document in Russia or even Germany with Hitler. It goes way back to the Paris de Sion, the Freemasons. And it got out, it leaked out, and they said when it did that it was a hoax or it was just an anti-Semitic hoax. And it is not. Here, for example, is some of the relevant information from the protocols that relate to the use of the media and what it's doing to your minds today. Protocol says, quote, in countries known as progressive and enlightened, we have created a senseless, filthy, abominable literature in order that the masses themselves may not guess what they are about. The spiritual beings, who you are, the powerful human beings. You can't guess what you're about through this literature. And what they, and further, we distract them, look over here, with amusements, games, pastimes, passions, peoples and palaces, etc. Isn't that interesting? You know, that reminds me of the movie Star Wars, where the bar scene, where all these bizarre-looking aliens are in the bar, smoky bar, toking up their nicotine, getting their nicotine fixing, drinking their beer. Pastimes, games, it reminds me of Sunday afternoon in any bar in America. Protocols goes on to say the recognition of our despot may also come before the destruction of the Constitution. Did you see last week's issue, October issue, 1999, of Harper's Magazine? Feature article on the front page said, guns are not killing you. The United States Constitution is. Here, protocols tells you, the recognition of our despot may also come before the destruction of the Constitution. The moment for this recognition will come when the peoples, utterly wearied by the irregularities and incompetence, a matter which we shall arrange for, of their rulers, will clamor, away with them. Give us one king over all the earth who will unite us and annihilate the causes of discords, frontiers, nationalities, religions, state debts, who will give us peace and quiet, which we cannot find under our rulers and representatives. Isn't that perfect? The way that they've been taking out confidence in the United States government is perfectly par for the course. When you can watch on the evening news the oral sex habits of your commander-in-chief, I think it's time that we have a new world order. You know, God wants a new world order too. He just doesn't want to have it run by corporate fascists. Protocols goes on to say, quote, but you yourself perfectly well know that to produce the possibility of the expression of such wishes by all the nations, it is indispensable to trouble in all countries the people's relationships with their governments so as to utterly exhaust humanity with dissension, hatred, struggle, envy, and even by the use of torture, by starvation, by the inoculation of diseases. Reflects back on our work with vaccines in the expose I began with. By want, so that the manipulated see no issue than to take refuge in our complete sovereignty in money and in all else. Continue, quote, for a time perhaps we might be dealt with successfully with a coalition of the manipulated of all the world. But from this danger we are secured by the discord existing among them, whose roots are so deeply seated that they can never now be plucked up. Sure, go ahead, sheeple. Hate each other. Blacks hate whites. Whites hate blacks. Jews hate Gentiles. Christians hate Muslims. Go continue to do exactly what they have intended you to do. We are living in Satan's world down here, but I understand that very recently Satan lost his lease. Now, Anton Chaitkin, who, among others, is probably the world's leading expert in revealing the Illuminati and the connections, had this to say, quote, the Rockefeller Foundation had long financed the eugenics movement in England, like I shared with you earlier, and the genetics industry in America, a disturbing legacy for the private international apparatus, which, along with substantial support from the Scottish Rite Freemasons, has set the world up for a global holocaust under the UN flag. End quote. In fact, earlier in my work, I shared with you that the investment of the Nazi war chest at the end of World War II, according to the direction of Martin Bormann, Hitler and their partners, IG Farben and the Rockefellers, they went into, the money went into 750 corporations for the New Ordnung, New Order, or what is known as today the New World Order, according to President Bush's State of the Union message, echoed by Dan Quayle, and Henry Kissinger's first chapter in his most recent book is called The New World Order, where you have had, over the last several months, the whales eating the whales in the economic system, the world economic system, the international conglomerates, where you have, for example, Deutsche Bank AG, who we thought lost the war, bought out the, not long ago, J.P. Morgan Bank. You know J.P.? That's the little guy with a handlebar mustache in the middle of the Monopoly board. That's Mr. Moneybags. That's a big bank bought out by Deutsche Bank AG in the final New Ordnung, New World Order ending, the climax. So that's what it is all about. Of course, it was the Rockefellers that built the United Nations and largely control them. Now, again, let's take a look at more propaganda that you are just imbibing at their will. Revenge of the killer microbes. Are we losing the war against infectious diseases? And, of course, they tell you in things like this that it's the multiple antibiotic-resistant strains that are developed from the antibiotics that's creating these new risks. And, in fact, they're not telling you that they're creating these types of germs in labs. So we're getting all scared. They use fear to manipulate you and control you. Richard Preston, I'm currently working on a report of Richard Preston's latest report in The New Yorker. This is an earlier one in May 1998, where Richard Preston, who I exposed again in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, as a CIA counterintelligence propagandist, is heralded herein as having gaining information about biological weapons and bioterrorism even before Central Intelligence Agency agents get it. Now, how does he do that? That must make him a CIA agent administrator. Richard Preston, a very wonderful CIA operative. Most likely. Here we have all our headlines. Scientists discover vaccine to battle defiant superbugs, where they create the problem. It's standard Machiavellian manipulation. You create the problem, you create the superbugs, you put them out through the contaminated blood, through contaminated vaccines, then you create the solution, the expensive drugs, pharmaceuticals. Oh, too bad that people have to die along the way, but that just serves our depopulation agenda, if you're thinking as a Rockefeller. And you'll see more about that in a couple minutes. Here you have the face of a man. Every time I look at him, I could puke. General Norman Schwarzkopf, who lied in front of Congress, telling people, first of all, that he believed that the military, on their way to the Gulf War, that they had the option not to get the vaccines had they so desired. That was one lie. He had then lied, saying that he was not aware that Saddam Hussein held biological and chemical weapons in his arsenal, and yet then he ordered the destruction of the Camisea weapons arsenal that we show you in the videotape called Gulf War Syndrome, the Spreading Epidemic Cover-Up, in living color, that in that arsenal, many of the weapons had been, he said, in fact, his excuse for saying that he wasn't aware that they had biological weapons in the Camisea arsenal, in front of the American people, in front of Congress in a hearing, he said, how could I have known? I couldn't read Arabic. Excuse me. He couldn't have had a CIA agent who speak Arabic translate, but you see, it was a lie. We show you in living color on our video that many, if not most of the containers were not written in Arabic. Many stated on them, shipped from Oklahoma. And this is the man who is leading the battle against prostate cancer and is asked by the cancer industry to lead the rally in Washington last summer. Look at him. Does a smiling face like that look like a satanically evil man? Not really, unless you know the background. Then you see how deceived we are. Then, of course, here's Time telling you about how wonderful the herbal medicine boom is. It's a great business, it says, but is it good for what ails us? And suddenly now you're told how wonderful herbs are. For decades, virtually this entire century, up until the 1990s, when the Rockefellers had vilified all the alternative therapies, including nutrition and herbology, and homeopathy, and acupuncture, and chiropractic, for lifting up the medical deities, the MDs, that now suddenly they're telling you how wonderful herbs are. Why do you think that happened? Because this decade, that virtually the entire herbal industry was bought out by the large pharmaceuticals conglomerates. So now they control the development of even the herbs that you and I are taking, at least most of them. That's why you got to be ideally growing your own, organically grown at home, ideally, or have knowledge about who specifically is growing them. Now here's another one. How dangerous are these people? These are the American anti-government zealots, an inside look at them, says Time. And who are these types of people that they articulate in these articles? Well, here's one for you. Colonel James Bogue writes. Can we focus a little bit, please? Colonel Bogue writes, America's most decorated war hero is an anti-government zealot. Why? Because he risked his own life to save Randy Weaver at Ruby Ridge, who won over $1 million settlement because the government was found to have come in and initiated that virtually the same way they initiated Waco and caused the death of those people. Does he look like an anti-government zealot? I don't know. He looks like a nice guy to me. Here's another guy, Terry and Janice Reed. Maybe focus that just slightly for us again. Terry and Janice Reed. You know, you remember hearing little rumors that the Clinton administration, President Clinton, was involved in the MENA airport drugs for arms scandal that Oliver North testified in front of Congress and lied in front of Congress and covered up in front of Congress about. In fact, a reporter one day asked President Bush, what's the story? Were you involved in the drugs for arms dealing in MENA airport? And he said, he stammered, and it was a Thursday afternoon, I remember it well. He then said, that was my predecessor. Talk to my predecessor, President Bush. Well, here's the fellow who exposed the whole thing. He's considered an anti-government zealot. He was a CIA operative involved in the training of the pilots in MENA Airport in southwestern Arkansas, about 140, 120 miles from Little Rock, where Governor Clinton was governor and was on the take when they were dropping out, millions of dollars. I think it was about $2 to $3 million a weekend on Dan Lasseter's ranch out of CIA stolen planes, heisted in an insurance scam. This is the guy and his wife who exposed it in his book, Compromise. I understand there's a movie being made on it right now. Here's a nice guy. It's Jack McLamb. He's listed as among America's most wanted terrorists and anti-Semites. So here you have the Jew kissing the anti-Semite. You know, and Jack and Bo, they've got some property like I have in northern Idaho. You know, I told you about a year ago we moved to northern Idaho. And people, particularly my Jewish colleagues, say to me, what are you, nuts? What'd you move to northern Idaho for? Don't you know there are Nazis up there? I say, yeah, somebody's got to keep an eye out on them. So the truth about it is you're reading in these scandal sheets, in these newspapers, that there are lots of Nazis living in northern Idaho. Well, you know what? There's a few. In fact, they live about, I'd say about 30 miles south of me, most of them in Hayden Lake. There's one old Nazi, actually. What it really is, and what it amounts to, is this. There's an old Nazi hanging out in Hayden Lake, and he's got about a half a dozen skinhead lunatics who support him, and that the real Nazis are really living in the high rises of New York City. And they fund this guy. And so what happens is that about once a year, sometime around summertime, they go to the mayor's office in City Hall of Coeur d'Alene to take out a petition to march. And that then the mayor and the city hall alerts the sheriff, and the sheriff alerts the FBI, and the FBI alerts Southern Poverty Law and Anti-Defamation League, and all of those people have to justify their existence and the millions of taxpayer dollars that they are spending to protect us from racism and anti-Semitism. So then what happens is the day of the march comes, and you read about it. In fact, what happens is you get about, at most, 24 skinheads and Nazis that they bring in from all across America, and they march in Coeur d'Alene, surrounded by about 3,000 of normal, loving human beings who are shouting four-letter words at these lunatics. And you read about it on your front page headlines that the Nazis are alive and well in the Northwest, northern Idaho, and don't go there. The Nazis are alive and well in New York, in the United Nations. Don't go there. So in chapter 5, we go into exposing deceptions further and decoding the truth. And suddenly, your life begins to change because the documentation that we show you before your eyes, you're suddenly stunned about. You see, what made the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola the best-selling hardcover that it is that folks like you saw the documentation because the story is so unbelievable. The truth is far more bizarre than fiction. And what made this book a best-selling hardcover is the fact that I, as a behavioral scientist, knew that the vast majority of you would never in your worst nightmares imagine that this was the case. And so I needed to reprint in black and white the most stunning documents that I had to show you I wasn't making it up. Likewise, in Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, suddenly in Chapter 5, you are facing some extraordinary documents that are virtually in everybody's libraries, in Webster's Dictionary, and in the Bible. You see in Webster's that there are hidden entries and cross-references to hidden entries. Why is that? Because you see that Noah Webster had lots of friends in the Constitutional Committee that put this country together. Many of them were the highest level Freemasons. You read in the encyclopedias that Noah Webster created Webster's Dictionary based on the Bible. He knew the Bible was encoded, and he himself put into Webster's Dictionary certain codes, hidden entries, and cross-references to such. And so it was through studying these hidden entries and following the codes that Joey found in Webster's the definitions of the ancient musical notes. And when I said to you that this relates to the gathering in the end times of the 144,000 humble servants of God who will sing the praises of the Lord in such a manner, profound manner, that it will instantaneously create the Messianic age, I'm not just whistling Dixie. You can read about it right from Webster's. Here from Webster's are the definitions of the tones. The first tone, not do, re, mi, not do, it is ut quiant laxus, and it is defined in Webster's as, quote, the entire scale, range, or gamut of dramatic emotion from grief to joy. That, in essence, is the entire human condition. Also, interestingly enough, it's a, quote, unit of magnetic field strength equal to 10 to the fifth power Gauss. What's 10 to the fifth? 100,000. 100,000. Add 44,000, 1 plus 4 plus 4 is 9. Completion. 144,000 is also what these tones, several of them are harmonically related to. The Bible prophesied 144,000. The second note. Resonus vibris in Latin or resonance in English. Now put on your thinking caps and listen up. It's defined in Webster's as, quote, a vibration of large amplitude in a mechanical or electrical system caused by a relatively small periodic stimulus of the same or nearly the same period as the natural vibration period of the entire system. Or, continue quote, a larger than normal vibration produced in response to a stimulus whose frequency is close to the natural frequency of the vibrational system. Said another way, a note that could be small, periodically sang or played, whose frequency is like the general electromagnetic frequency of the entire universe, God's magnificent system, that has the power to produce an extraordinarily, profoundly large impact, such as a quality of enriched significance, profundity, and elusiveness, as a poem has resonance beyond its superficial meaning or surface meaning. Now listen to this, continue quote, an action in answer to or intended to undo a situation, or that performance of the new action brings back an earlier state of affairs. We're going back to God, folks. The third tone is me. Mirigestorum in Latin. Miracles in English. It's defined, you know, as an extraordinary occurrence that surpasses all known human powers or natural forces and is ascribed to a divine or supernatural cause, especially to God, end quote. Miracles. MI. This is Dr. Lee Lorenzen, what he looks like experimenting in his laboratory. This is the world's leading expert in clustered water, nutrition, nutritional biochemistry, and genetics. This is the man who studied the healing wells of the world and developed the clustered water and said that God's holy water, healing water, is six-sided hexagonal-shaped rings. This is the picture of the water that he produced. Six side. God spoke the world into existence in 6 days. Jericho's wall fell in 6 days. The universe itself is clustered in planets in six hexagonal shapes. Here is clustered water of Dr. Lorenzen, and here is the clustered water, six-sided hexagonal shape from Lourdes, France, from the healing well at Lourdes, France. Six-sided shape is discussed in the journal Science, volume 271, 1996, February 16th, where Richard Sakely, who's University of California chemistry department chairperson, discussed the clustered waters and the fact that the waters, in fact, are clustered, and by being clustered as crystals being electromagnetic receivers and transmitters, have the power to store knowledge and store frequencies and store healing power and store miracles. Dr. Lorenzen, before he knew what I found in the Bible, that the third note, or what Joey found and I reported in the Bible, that the third note is 528. The note for miracles, Miragastorum, is 528. When I shared that over dinner, Lorenzen laughed with joy. He said, "Len, that's incredible." He says, "You know what? I added the 528 frequency to the clustered water because I know all the leading world's leading genetic biochemists understand that 528 is the repair frequency for damaged DNA, the blueprint of life. And that what he showed us subsequently was the research literature. Now pay attention, because this is stunning new information that has only been revealed this decade by the world's leading genetic biochemists. In fact, three of the five Nobel Prize winners in medicine this decade received their prize money for research in the field of what's called photon-phonon emissions, intercellular communications based on the DNA, and that the DNA, we have learned, the reason why you have the tight helical structures of the DNA is because they're supported by a structure of the six-sided hexagonal-shaped crystal-clustered water molecules that God creates in nature. The infants and children are full of it. The first breast milk is full of clustered water molecules. And that what causes the DNA to function primarily is the crystalline lattice. Again, crystals are what? Electromagnetic receivers and transmitters. We found out this decade, folks, contrary to popular belief, contrary to what we learned in medicine and dentistry and the healing arts and sciences, we learned that DNA's function primarily is in protein synthesis. Wrong! Start over. New knowledge. Here it is. The primary function of DNA is to act as an electromagnetic receiver and transmitter. Electromagnetic receiver and transmitter of virtually God's love. That's what allows you to go to sleep at night feeling so lousy and wake up suddenly in the morning refreshed, because the DNA, surrounded by the clustered crystal water, is receiving God's love, which is given freely to us all the time. It picks that up and transmits it to the rest of the cells so that you can have Miragastorum, miracles. That's what DNA is. Now, when you see the potential changes of the DNA, the electrical potential and its ability or inability to transmit electromagnetic signals is highly dependent on the water. Suddenly, when you deplete the water, for example, as little as 8% of the depletion of the crystal clusters around the DNA, suddenly your cells can't communicate anymore. And besides, the cell's not communicating anymore. Guess what? Your 4,000 plus enzymes in your body, responsible for virtually every metabolic function, the structure is a protein. It works via lock and key. The structure is important in order to unlock the metabolic functions and have them work. And that also, research this decade only, has found is caused by the six-sided hexagonal-shaped crystal clusters. So Revelation was right. In the end, the crystal clear waters will flow through the people, and that will be associated with the great miraculous healing of the nations. We've discovered this technology based on this research. Here's what happens. See, it goes, DNA will go from this beautiful tight double helix structure when it's supported with the clustered water, which has high electromagnetic conductivity, to very low conductivity, where it's either reduced, squashed, or kind of extended when it loses as little as 8%. Now, that's the DNA connection. The DNA connection to the crystal clustered water relates to the 5 to 8 frequency of Miragastorum. Now, when you think about the primary compulsion of the Illuminati has been, particularly this century, to clean up the dysgenic races, creating from eugenics the Human Genome Project, the study of the genetic predispositions for diseases and the genes associated with diseases for all the races. And you realize that these people have a compulsive drive to maintain the purity of the bloodline and the DNA and the genetics. And then suddenly you realize that their principal intelligence agency, their Gestapo in a nutshell, is who but MI6, Miragastorum 6, 5, 2, 8, 5 plus 2 is 7, plus 8 is 15, 1 plus 5 is 6, MI6. You have just diagnosed and exposed the origin of the British Secret Service, who is virtually running all the intelligence agencies of the world. It comes right from the Bible and the highest levels of the secret societies. The fourth note. Familitorum. Here's where it gets fun. It's defined as familitorum or familis, or the family. It's defined as the servants or attendants, especially of a scholarly or magical nature. The number of members of a group required to be present to transact the business or carry out an activity legally, particularly, or a particularly chosen group. You know, in the Jewish religion, for example, when somebody dies, you need a dozen men to sit Shiva, to pray for the elevation of the spirit. That's a particularly chosen group. That's a familis. In the end times, what we're referring to here is a specially chosen group of 144,000 scholarly magical servants of God who will in these end times sing the praises of the Lord, these particular six notes that relate to creation, destruction, and the repair of DNA, miracles, and that's the chosen group that we're talking about here. The fifth note is solve pollute. What does it mean? Solve the problem or solve the pollution. Defined in Webster's, to solve a mystery or a puzzle, to work out the answer or a solution, particularly to a mathematical problem, says Webster. This is a mathematical problem, folks, that we are dealing with, from the corruption of the languages to the manipulations that you will see in part two in a few minutes. The bio-spiritual warfare, sound, tone, mathematics. Solve a pollute, to solve the problem. It is like a cleansing with water or liquid, especially of a religious ritual. You want to baptize the world? Bring everybody home to God? That's the problem. That's the big problem, and it's a mathematical one. It deals with God's technology and God's language, which is mathematics. Finally, the last note of the sixth ancient musical scale of the solfeggio is labiaratum, or the lips, the labium, the lips. It relates to, pertaining to the lips. Continue quote, a reverse. Now listen. A reverse movement or tendency, an action in a reverse direction or manner, a movement toward extreme political conservatism. You know, I don't know about you, but I don't know anyone or anything more conservative than God. Do you? We're moving back. We're going to go into a reverse direction because I don't know about you, I haven't been happy about the direction it's been going for a while. Continue quote out of Webster's for labiaratum, the meaning, a desire to return to an earlier system or order. The instantaneous response of a system to an applied force. Webster's tells you right here that what we're looking at with the recovery of the ancient musical scale are the sacred tones that have the power to create the instantaneous reverse movement to bring this back, this planet back to God. Are you interested? I am. Now, to show you that today's musical scale has been completely manipulated, specifically with the addition of the final note, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, well, the note T never was in it. It relates back to C, sancta Ionis, or Sancta Johannes, C, later became T. Now, just focus in on your hearts for a minute. Allow your intuition to speak to you. Feel the vibratory essence of the definition of this term and see if it has any semblance, any relationship whatsoever to the previous divine six tones. Here's what this says. Here's the definition of the note C, or T, out of Webster's. Quote, a person of exceptional holiness. Sounds like the Pope. The Pope who was recently, like, for example, Pope Pius XII, who in the recent edition, October issue of Vanity Fair magazine, was shown to have intimate connections to Adolf Hitler and helped the Nazi powers to rise. Oh, that's unfortunate for the good Catholics among you. You, unfortunately, like all the rest of us and all the other religions, have been royally deceived. But a person of exceptional holiness, a body of rules, principles or standards accepted as axiomatic and universally binding. Does that sound like God? A constant note-for-note imitation of one melodic line by another, in which the second line starts after the first, a proposition in logic or mathematics that is assumed without proof for the sake of studying consequences that will follow from it, such as the consequences of human enslavement. Do you get my drift? Do you see what I'm saying? This is dramatically different in definition from the previous six tones. Ultimately, through the Apocrypha study, Joey found the sacred hymn to St. John the Baptist, the most powerful spiritual hymn that, in Joey's terms, had the capacity to lift up mankind to Godkind, to create, in essence, what the Christians have longed for and has been prophesied, the bride, God's joyful children and playmate. And it says, quote, so that your servants, your humble servants, can sing together with the loose strings, the vocal cords through the lips, the wonders of their deeds, the miracles and the potential miracles that we can produce together when we sing together in harmony through the Spirit of God. Oh, St. John, wash away the guilt from their polluted lips that came about initially with the formation of the dialects, and the lips became polluted. And then on top of that, all the doctrine and all the dogma and all the other stuff that it tells you right in the Bible, don't fall into that. It says again in 1 Corinthians, when you study it, Christ tells you, for you to know the Spirit, for you to really understand God and know the Spirit, it's not about the dogma. You have to go directly to the source of the experience of the Spirit. And from that, all the pollution falls out. Chapter 6 in the final chapter in the first part of the book that delivers the good news, and before we take an intermission break, let me just share with you, is that Joey has advanced a very fascinating thesis that I think deserves subsequent investigation and application by herbalists, naturopaths, and people who simply want to play and learn God's gift to healing herbology. In fact, the Bible talks about 156, I think it is, different herbs for various types of illnesses. And again, we are told that we will have the leaves of the trees that will help support our world healing. So, healing codes relate to the use of the languages and the alphanumeric translation of the English and Latin root words of the herbs back to its mathematic primary derivative. And again, based on Pythagorean mathematics, where you only had 9 numbers, 1 through 9. Joey then theorized, well, there must only therefore be 9 diseases and 9 cures. So that using the alphanumerics and reducing the letters, the alphanumeric sum, to its single-digit integer, he then gives us a chart of all of the herbs and their numbers and all of the diseases that we suffer from today and their numbers. And he says, if you want to participate in the research, we welcome you. Please let us know how you're doing, because if you now begin to produce your herbal formulas based on this knowledge, he, as a world-leading herbalist, says that that's how he is deriving his most effective formulas. And he invites your participation in this research. So that's the exciting news in Chapter 6, must reading for herbalists. We also go into some of the other work of Dinshaw in sound and color and the frequencies and what notes they relate to. We certainly have a lot of work to do. We have, for example, a scientific challenge in order for us to apply effectively this new technology. We're working currently with at least 6 musicians and physicists and scholars and healers who are using electromedical techniques around the world. And I've asked a number of them to get back to me regarding one important question. My important question at this point is, currently we are using a base 10 mathematical system. The ancient Levi priest used Pythagorean mathematics. It was a base 9 scale. So does that mean we need to translate the tone, let's say G, which is 397, back to the original math in order to have it have its full effect? These are the scientific, mathematical, and physical questions that we are asking today. You have to give the folks who are involved in this research time and your patience. Because don't forget, the Illuminati has been able to work with these for 3,000 years, and we're going to show you in the next segment after the intermission. But we ourselves now, the masses, suddenly now having these revelations, it's going to take us a little bit of time to figure out really how powerful these codes are and what to do with them to bring about world healing. Here are examples of what Joey shows you with disease conditions. Here are disease conditions with their alphanumeric equivalents. And then here are herbs, the herb numbers with their alphanumeric equivalents. So that's it for the first segment of Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse. When we come back, be prepared for the bad news. It's a good thing you got the good news. Thanks a lot. See you soon. Thank you. Welcome back. Part 2, Healing Codes of the Biological Apocalypse. You know, I had somebody come up to me during the break and said, you know, aren't you afraid that some people might get a hold of these codes and use them for evil? Well, that's exactly what we're going to be learning about during this program. They've literally been doing that for 3,000 years. And again, you could imagine in the end times prophecies and the scenarios that are now coming to fruition that Satan and his boys haven't been resting on their laurels. and that they would evolve the most advanced biospiritual technologies for warfare using this information. And that's precisely what we're going to be dealing with today. So in essence, what we have simply done is we have worked for God to bring back to humanity the sacred wisdom of how God operates, which is the function of the Spirit. It's virtually the technology of the Spirit. And that's why I began with 1 Corinthians explaining that you've got to know, ideally you've got to know the tongues, the languages, and the Spirit and the meaning behind that. And also in the Bible it says, my people are slain for lack of knowledge and the wisdom. Well, that's now apparently we are simply humble servants of God delivering back to the ignorant masses the sacred knowledge that now God has deemed necessary for the masses to take the next step towards the messianic age. And so in the process, we are like children. We are just getting a hold of this incredibly important and powerful knowledge, and we need to do a little bit of testing with it. It's like a child with a new toy. We might get burned a little bit before we learn how to ride a bike, for example, when recently training Elena how to ride a two-wheeler. She's got to fall off the bike a little bit first. Now, hopefully that this technology will be used by the vast masses of loving humanity, which really we are. There's very few people who have been manipulating the show all these centuries, and that these people have held this knowledge. And you're going to see how they've applied that in the second part of the book, which begins with chapter 7, called Mad Cows and Madder Men, where suddenly we begin to entertain, what is this issue of mad cow disease, the protein prions? And we realize that there is links to biological weapons industry again. We realize, reflecting on, for example, this we show you is a Department of Defense appropriations request for $10 million for a 5-year study. In fact, that's precisely what you see here. In fact, this was the document, the most horrifying document I'd ever seen that initiated my 3-year investigation into the origins of AIDS and Ebola viruses, because here was a definition of what the AIDS virus is and does, functionally and descriptively identical to what HIV does, about, 10 years at least before the first cases of AIDS were seen in New York. The Department of Defense appropriations request for synthetic biological agents for germ warfare was looking for, within the next 5 to 10 years, a new infective microorganism that could differ in certain important aspects from any known disease-causing organisms. Most important of these is that it might be refractory to the immunologic and therapeutic processes upon which we depend to maintain our relative freedom from infectious diseases. End quote. That sounds exactly like a definition of AIDS, now doesn't it? So at any rate, I show you that document as it relates to Dr. Robert Gallo's work at Litton Bionetics, and I only do this to review what was in Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, because it was an extraordinary discovery for me to realize that this was not only linked to depopulation, and of course here in Chapter 7 from Foreign Affairs Journal, which is the most esteemed political periodical in the world. This, in fact, was the journal, again, this is Council of Foreign Relations published journal, and that this was to draw attention to the world's leading military medical industrialists and international banksters for the urgent need to reduce now, in the 1990s, the United States' population. So no longer third world. In fact, it says here that we'd like to achieve these goals for the U.S. population in the range of 125 to 150 million, or about its size in the 1940s, that this would be the optimum size. Of course, they say to be reached in 3 or 4 generations if we do 2 things. And, of course, they talk about family planning, but they don't really talk about the genocidal germs. Now, in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, we show you that the document that I just showed you, the Department of Defense Appropriations, was virtually Henry Kissinger's order to Melvin Laird in 1969 when he became National Security Advisor under Richard Nixon. That's the most powerful man overseeing CIA, FBI, and foreign policy. And Kissinger at the time was acting at the behest of George Bush, who at the time was congressman of Texas before he was CIA director. Of course, his father, you remember, was Prescott Bush, one of the originators of eugenics, genocide. First racial hygiene laws were in the United States in the 1920s. I reviewed that in their previous works. But Kissinger now is responding to Bush, George Bush, standing up in Congress in 1968, saying that we need to reduce third world populations dramatically as U.S. national security's primary focus. Otherwise, we're going to be overrun by these black people, was what was intimated. So Kissinger then penned the National Security Memorandum 200 that called for massive third world depopulation. Of course, not long after that, we show you in Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, he sent CIA operatives into Central Africa to foment the unrest in Zaire, Angola, create the Zaire-Angola War that continues to this very day. That is the heart of the African AIDS belt. That is close to ground zero for Ebola. And now, against this military biological weapons background and the depopulation agenda background, we show you again the links to the world's leading depopulation funding agencies. Here they are. Includes the Merck Fund, Merck Sharp and Dohme, giving you all your contaminated vaccines, and the Rockefeller Foundation, the people who put together the international blood banksters. It was Lawrence Rockefeller, for example, who put together the New York City Blood Bank. These became first the Blood Council. They put together the New York City Blood Council. That was the council of doctors that put together the New York City Blood Bank. They became the international blood banksters. These are the wonderful people that allowed for 10,000 hemophiliacs throughout the United States and countless others throughout the world to get the HIV-contaminated blood that they knew was contaminated between 1980 and 86 and did nothing significant to clean up the blood. At the same time, they allowed the other contaminations to go through the blood, the hepatitis types of viruses, hepatitis B and C. Of course, there's class action lawsuits pending now. If we could have the next slide, carousel. Oh, I'm sorry, here it is. Here you see, for example, a class action lawsuit being heralded in the papers in Canada. In British Columbia, they're requesting people come forward to join a class action lawsuit if they got transfused in BC between August 1st, 1986 and July 1st, 1990. Join the class action lawsuit, thanks to the Rockefellers. So now we begin to show you that much of this relates, this population reduction agenda, relates to a report from Iron Mountain on the possibility and the desirability of peace, in which they developed scenarios for a new world order where one world government and international boundaries would come down, be replaced by one world government, wherein now you would have to substitute for traditional military warfare what they call non-lethal military warfare, or non-lethal warfare, which included things like hurting, harming, maiming the population for additional population control. They, in fact, cited specifically human enslavement, a form of slavery. We'll talk more about that in a couple of minutes. But this relates to the Freemasons. So this report from Iron Mountain was published by the Dial Press. Remember I told you in the first segment? Dial. The Dial Press. The dialects. The introduction of the dialects to separate the sheeple, to manipulate, coerce, enslave, control, and kill, if necessary. Depopulation. And here it is in 1967, published the work of the 1963 think tank for the United States government and also the British, with material produced by Leonard C. Lewin, published by Dial Press. And who is the president of Dial? Nobody other than John W. Teats, who in this announcement is promoting Freemasonry. So suddenly you see the connection between the Dial Press that published the report from Iron Mountain for the desirability of manipulation and coercion of the masses and population reduction as well as enslavement with the Freemasons. And then the stunning revelation that came to me during this investigation, and Captain Joyce Riley contributed this work to me, was the recognition that the Project MKUltra, this is from the congressional hearings, the CIA's program for behavioral research and behavior modification, that MKUltra, the mind control and population control program, guess what? A subordinate part of that was the biological weapons. The biological weapons that I had exposed in depth, the MK Naomi project that we exposed in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, was a subordinate part of the MK Ultra project. And part of the project was to develop biologicals that had complete predictability. So when they developed, when they ordered the development of viruses that were descriptively and functionally identical to HIV/AIDS, according to the congressional record, the CIA's primary function, purpose of this MK Naomi project, subsidiary of MK Naomi, mind control and population control, including depopulation, included to provide for, this is quote, to provide for the required surveillance, testing, upgrading, and evaluation of materials and items in order to assure absence of defects and complete predictability of the results to be expected under operational conditions. So you think it's an accident that today 73% of HIV/AIDS cases in America are black and Hispanic? Suppose the same coincidence that 55% of the gay people are dead. That's the same exact number, approximately, that Central African villages are wiped out. 55%. And another U.S. government document that I was given showed that even that wasn't good enough for some of the population controllers. They needed to reduce populations even further than that, and they were specifically talking about AIDS, HIV/AIDS. Published by the Bureau of Economics, mind you. Given to me by a Pentagon official. See, we have people on the inside who give us information too. And on the inside, there are people who are screaming and dying because it's an assault to their own spirituality. What's going on here? So, we show you some hideous documents and facts that relate to what is going on today with not only mad cow disease, but with other illnesses that relate to the special virus cancer program and the people that Dr. Robert Gallo and others work with. Here, for example, from Baylor College of Medicine, is the studies on viruses as related to cancer and the emphasis with leukemia. This is Jack Gruber, that's Robert Gallo's boss at the National Cancer Institute. The purpose is to isolate, propagate, identify viral agents to provide evidence of association with human neoplasia and to continue to hold observed primates inoculated, primates, monkeys, and humans with suspected cancer viruses or cancerous tissues. Now, where do you get humans for these studies? Not hard. Huntsville Prison, Texas. Also, the minority populations that have been routinely targeted for genocide. Here, out of the same study, they're going to inject the role of herpes viruses type 2 in cervical carcinoma. We're going to do, of course, zero epidemiological studies, which means they're going to evaluate their blood to see if the presence of the virus exists, they tell us. Studies of women with invasive cervical cancer. Who are the women? Oh, just so coincidentally, Muslim women, Christian women. And then, where are they? Israeli women? You see that somewhere here? And Ugandan women. Black, Jews, Arabs, and Christians. Oh, isn't that interesting? Baylor College. And who did they choose to inoculate? Who were the primates that they inoculated with the cancer viruses and the infectious agents? Oh, they went into Huntsville Prison, Baylor University School of Medicine did. And they injected, for example, 46 prisoners, inmates, on 9-10-70, 1970, with mycoplasma pneumonia vaccine study. Mycoplasma pneumonia. Mycoplasma is what is associated with the ongoing class action lawsuit in Huntsville today. Here you have Huntsville sick plaintiffs who are in the class action lawsuit. See, what happened was they injected the Huntsville prisoners. And again, according to reputable authorities, some of this research, some of the vaccines that they were testing, which contained the contaminants that were given not only to the Gulf War troops. Now, go back to the Gulf War syndrome, the spreading epidemic cover-up video, that tape that we produced, and you learn that Tanox Biomedical Systems of Houston, Texas, you will learn that Tanox Biomedical Systems of Houston, Texas, co-owned by James Baker III, major shareholder George Bush, had, according to reputable authorities, produced the vaccines that were tested in Huntsville Prison. And the prisoners developed Gulf War syndrome long before the Gulf War. And they gave it because it's partly, if not largely, an infectious disease, mycoplasma being a cross between a bacteria and a virus, and the most common vaccine contaminant of all, they gave it to the prison guards, who gave it to their wives or spouses, who then gave it to their pets and children, and even some of the healthcare professionals in Huntsville came down sick and have died from this illness now. Here is the list of names and the list of diseases associated with those studies, according to the plaintiff's testimony. Here is the number of civilians killed and the cause of death. Now, what's most fascinating is we present to you, not most fascinating, but certainly fascinating, is we present to you this document in Healy Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, Chapter 8, where you see suddenly the United States government patent on this pathogenic mycoplasma, isolated by Dr. Lowe of Potomac, Maryland, patent assigned to the American Registry of Pathology, and Dr. Lowe's affiliation is with the Armed Forces Institute of Pathology. Military, isolation, culture, propagation, and testing of a pathogenic mycoplasma. Now, they patented it in September 7, 1993. And what Dr. Lowe relates in the patent is very important. It's important for two reasons. For HIV/AIDS patients, it's important because he tells you right in here, just like Dr. Peter Duesberg was saying, although still I believe that Dr. Duesberg is a Hegelian dialectic activist, he is the fellow who says that HIV doesn't cause AIDS, he's correct. I always said that. I always said also what Gallo says is a thesis, HIV causes AIDS, Duesberg says is the antithesis, they were both working together intimately. Now you have the Hegelian dialectic activated synthesis, mass confusion, people don't know who to believe anymore. But Duesberg claimed, and I believed him all the time, he said HIV doesn't cause AIDS. I knew you could have HIV/AIDS and still get cured. You can eliminate the virus from the body, and that wouldn't kill you. So does Lowe in his patent. He says what causes the symptoms of AIDS is this pathogenic mycoplasma. And that it should not be foreign to us that many of us were used as experimental guinea pigs, such as what now the concern is that the contrails, or chemtrails rather, the spraying of chemicals, such as the JPA jet fuel that admittedly, according to a CDC toxicologist in a letter I received, stated, yes, we do believe, we know that some JPA jet fuel is being used and it does contain ethylene dibromide, which we know is a known human chemical carcinogen. And that what's happening is that immune systems are being suppressed, and we linked this disease that occurred heavily last winter, starting actually in the end of summer last year, went through the winter, where you had about a third of the United States public having this upper respiratory infection that would not quit. People were hacking and coughing, having sinus headaches and congestions, feeling malaise, not quite themselves, wouldn't keep you home from work. You were about 80% yourself. You go to a physician, maybe get some antibiotics. It helped for you for a couple days as it killed off secondary bacterial infections. But then you get a little tired, run down, came right back again. For months, weeks and months, people, your friends and mine, suffer with this. And not a word was said about this by the Centers for Disease Control. And they make money by putting out their press releases about every single little outbreak. Six people, for example, in New York get this West African encephalitis, this Nile encephalitis. And it's a big thing. It's so big, they got to spray malathion, a known human chemical carcinogen related to Agent Orange, out of black helicopters in order to kill off the mosquito population. Same scam they ran about a year and a half ago when you had on the CBS Evening News Dan Rather reporting black helicopters flying over Miami Beach and Los Angeles spraying malathion. For what? According to Dan Rather and Associated Press, again, mouthpieces for Central Intelligence, it was for a, quote, fruit fly infestation, end quote. Now, what kind of fruit flies do they have? Primarily in Miami Beach, in New York City, and in Los Angeles. Why, black, Hispanic, and Jewish fruit flies, don't you know? But you see, Dr. Lowe shared with us that this upper respiratory infection that wouldn't quit was associated with a mycoplasma. So as the toxic chemicals deplete the immune system, They're kind of like using the Russian cocktail approach to non-lethal military warfare and depopulation. You can't figure out they're hitting us with so many cofactor type of diseases that you can't really find out the primary sources or what's really going on. But we feel strongly that this upper respiratory tract infection that wouldn't quit was associated with the mycoplasma that Dr. Lowe wrote about, because that's what he said is exactly the type of infection that these mycoplasmas produce. And it would not surprise us if we review the congressional record. Up and through into the 1990s, this law from the United States Annotated Code, Title 50, for War and National Defense, Chapter 32 of the Chemical and Biological Warfare Program, approved in 1996, mind you, reiterated earlier laws that allowed for the use of human subjects for testing of chemical and biological agents by the Department of Defense and their contractors. Civilians, without gaining informed consent, the only thing according to this law that it's articulated, their need was to inform one public official 30 days in advance, and any military biological chemical weapons contractor could test virtually anything they wanted to, and God help that one public official that they informed. So it should not surprise us that what is going on is an activation, a reactivation, a regurgitation of the depopulation agenda. Now, without belaboring the issue, you know, there's some very disturbing information that we present to you in Chapter 7. I told you that genocide is defined as the mass extermination of people for political motives. The Merck Fund heavily involved. From the report from Iron Mountain, published by the Dial Press of New York, in Under the Functions of War and the Substitutes for the Functions of War, that's their quote, here's what their study, special study group, special in military circles is covert, it's secret. Here's what their secret study group wrote under ecological concerns. Quote, war has not been genetically progressive. Oh, what a shame. But as a system of gross population control to preserve the species, it cannot be fairly faulted. There is no question but that a universal requirement that procreation be limited to the products of artificial insemination would provide a fully adequate substitute control for population levels. Sounds like the development of your clinics, doesn't it? Such a reproductive system would, of course, have the added advantage of being susceptible to direct eugenic, there's that word from the 1920s, management. Its predictable further development, conception, and embryonic growth taking place wholly under laboratory conditions would extend these controls to their logical conclusions. The ecological function of war under these circumstances would not only be superseded, but surpassed in effectiveness. Emphasis, continue quote, the indicated intermediate step, total control of conception with a variant of the ubiquitous pill via water supplies or essential foodstuffs, with the genetic manipulation of the foodstuffs, the terminator genes, the water supplies containing fluoride and chlorine, toxic, and the vaccines, which we showed you in our previous tape, Horowitz on vaccines and other work, that the reason primarily that the Africans are sterile, that the reason so many black women, in fact, 25% of Native American women, I'm sorry, 35% of Native American women, 25% of black women living in urban America are sterile. In the United States today, how do they get sterile? The most likely primary cause is primarily because of the vaccines that contain human chorionogonadic trophic hormone, that's HCG, that was a female sterilizing agent that was given to, at least we know now, 2.5 million women without their knowledge, mostly in the Philippines, South America, Mexico, and some in North America as well. So this is what they're talking about here, like you relate back to what I shared with you about the protocols of the Elders of Zion, for the inoculation of diseases and depopulation effects, there would appear to be no foreseeable need to revert to any of the outmoded practices referred to in the previous section, infanticide or really destructive wars. And that echoes precisely what Bertrand Russell wrote in his 1955 work called The Impact of Science and Society. Bertrand Russell, with highest level aristocratic family ties and highest level ties to the British Secret Service, wrote the same exact thing. And he urged for a black death to be prescribed once in every generation so survivors, quote, could procreate freely without making the world too full. He says, continue, quote, this situation would be somewhat unpleasant, but what of that? Really high-minded people are indifferent to happiness, particularly other people's, end quote. So in chapter 8, we go back and begin to take a serious look, new look, at these things called protein prions. The chapter is called Prions and the Lords of Misrule. And we learn that prions research is going strongly at the University of Chicago affiliated Howard Hughes Medical Research Institute. University of Chicago, for those who are familiar with my book, Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola, knows that's where Dr. Robert Gallup comes from. Knows that's where Rockefeller funded and built the University of Chicago. Knows that's where some of the top bioweapons experts came from. And that, of course, University of Chicago joins Litton Bionetics, Dow Chemical, University of Maryland, where Dr. Gallup currently works, Hazleton Research Labs, where there was a Hazleton monkey outbreak and the virus outbreak, the Ebola-like virus outbreak, and the New York University Medical Center, the home of the infamous hepatitis B vaccine trials given first to the children at Willowbrook that killed so many of them, and then to the gay men in New York City and the blacks in Central Africa. That research originated here. This from the Congressional Record. This is a United States government document. This is a list of biological weapons contractors for the late 60s. And we go back suddenly and go back into the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola to page 452 and 453, where I reprinted in black and white the United States government document, the report from John Landon at Litton Bionetics to the National Cancer Institute staff reporting for the special secret virus cancer program, the list, the menu of the mutant viruses and mutant virus recombinants that they held in their labs at the time working for allegedly cancer research. And it was really biological weapons research, because here, for example, you take a look. Here they combine acute lymphocytic leukemia viruses, quick-acting leukemia viruses with influenza and para-influenza to produce airborne leukemia virus that would spread leukemia by sneezing. Excuse me. Are you trying to tell me that's for cancer research? Why, after all, that's a cancer research contract report. I don't believe that. And if not for cancer research, was this done for biological weapons research and development? This, after all, was the Army's sixth top biological weapons contractor. No, I can't believe that either. You know why? Because leukemia kills too slowly. It's not like Ebola that kills 9 out of 10 people within 3 weeks. You see, this is virtually identical to HIV/AIDS, a fabulous, non-traceable depopulation agent with one exception. HIV/AIDS is bloodborne pathogen. This is airborne. HIV/AIDS is far more easy to control through the contaminated blood and through contaminated vaccines. This is airborne. They couldn't really control that too well. Then you follow this list down, and what you finally find is this, Kuru. Kuru, that's the original name for mad cow disease protein prion. The disease called Kuru, which developed, they told us, naturally in the Foray people of New Guinea. The truth we show you, the origin of Kuru, most likely, according to all the evidence, dates back to the Japanese biological weapons researchers back in World War II. And at the end of World War II, they virtually left this biological weapons test experiment in the Australia area, and the Aborigines, and the Foray people of New Guinea. And they then, we got, America got, Japan's top biological weapons developer to come and work with our own biological weapons teams. And then they sent Carlton Gaiderchek, a convicted pedophile who went to prison and who was bailed out of prison largely by Dr. Robert Gallo. The World Health Organization, National Institute of Health, sent Carlton Gottacek to the 4A people of New Guinea to study this disease that they alleged was a bizarre illness that caused cannibals, brain eaters, to laugh themselves to death as their brains developed holes in it. So here we see that in 1971, that is on the list of the biological weapons contracting firm Litton Bionetics. And that woke me up. I suddenly began to investigate more thoroughly Kourou. And here's Gottacek. And what I found was amazing. And I reported this to Robert Cohen, who was a good colleague, a friend. He wrote the book, Milk the Deadly Poison. It's a great book. Here you see Kourou, and the H stands for humans, where Carlton Gottacek took this agent that caused Kourou, or minced tissues, from the brains of humans, and he injected them into 8 chimpanzees, they said. Primates, which might have included humans as well. Notice that in this particular study, Kourou, which is traditionally, or mad cow disease, or Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease in humans, which is traditionally a chronic illness, it takes a while before people develop these brain lesions and then die. Here suddenly, between April 1966 and May 1966, Gottacek, he's more commonly known as, injected 8 chimps, 4 of them died within 1 month. So what kind of an experiment was this? We learn in this chapter that prions are crystals. Crystals are electromagnetic receivers and transmitters. They grow like crystals. And according to the researchers at the Howard Hughes Institute for Medical Research, that these specific crystals grow in yeast. These types of crystals grow in yeast, which is a fungus. In a minute, I'll show you the new theory that we advance. But before I got to the new theory, I had a mind blower. Now, there's a portion of this chapter that is entitled Mind Blower. And I already told you that I had an angel sitting on my shoulder as I was doing this work. And as I was reviewing this section of the, writing this section of the book, I was actually doing research at the time that I was writing this section. The research was being conducted in Webster's Dictionary. And suddenly I began to sense and follow the codes. There were period codes, like 13th century, 14th century codes that I was suddenly inclined to follow. For example, how I got there was because when I reviewed the Howard Hughes Institute of Medical Research information about Kourou or mad cow disease, prion crystals, they added a new word to my vocabulary. In relation to what the prion crystal does, they said it caused apoptosis, which I didn't know what it meant. What it meant was, quote, planned cell death, end quote. Planned cell death. And I thought that's odd. I said, let me take a look if that word exists in Stedman's Medical Dictionary. So I looked it up there, and it wasn't in my 1970s edition, meaning it was a relatively newly invented medical term. And so I go back into Webster's, and I look up the prefix, apo, and I start to read. And I look and I read down, and suddenly I see apocalypse, and then it says more at hell. And I thought, oh, isn't that interesting? There's a cross-reference. And there's 13th century, more at hell, 13th century code. Apocalyptic, apocalism. Apocalypse, apochromatic, it suddenly caught my attention. Chroma, spectrum, electromagnetic frequencies. I said, oh, isn't that odd? Apocope, more at capon, I looked. Kept reading down. Look, loss of one or more sounds or letters. The end of a word. I thought, isn't that interesting? Apocrypha. Knowing Joey is involved in finding these revelations of missing terms and missing poems and everything in Apocrypha. Then it says, more at crypt. There's a cross-reference. Maybe I should check that out. There's a 14th century code. I go, that's interesting. 13th century, 14th century, 1314, apocryphal. So I began to follow these leads. So I was led to more at crypt. See, it said more at crypt. So I went to crypt. Here's crypt. And I began to read. You know, a chamber, wholly or partly underground, a vault under main floor, chamber, mausoleum, depression, crypt. Cryptorhythm? What? What's that? An arithmetic problem in which the letters have been substituted for the numbers. And which is solved by finding all the possible pairings of the digits with the letters that produce a numerically correct answer. I said, that's what Joey did. Cryptic. Secret, occult, mysterious, crypto, cryptus, a person who adheres or belongs to a secret party or sect. I said, wait a minute, what's going on here? Am I losing my mind? I kept reading. Cryptococcus, an infectious disease that is caused by a fungus. I go, that's what yeast is, a fungus. That's what we're dealing with prion crystals. Cryptocrystalline. Cryptogam, another, a fungus. Crystals, crystal, 13th century, more at crust. Crystalline material used in electronics, a frequency determining element for the rectification or electronics as frequency of powdered, also methamphetamine, and then crystal, 14th century code, again, lucid, Lucifer, Lucius. Crystal, crystalline, Lucius. I thought, am I losing my mind? I said, let me follow some of these leads, but God, please, can you help me here? Am I just going crazy? Maybe I'm just projecting my blind conspiracy theory bias into Webster's dictionary. Lord, can you help me out? I really can use a hand here. That was my prayer at that moment. And when you read that section of the book, you are in my mind at the exact moment it's happening. It's going right onto the computer. So I follow the 13th century code to the next one up. The next 13th century code I find is heir. Heir. One who inherits or is entitled to inherit property. And then it says heir, 14th century, 1314, there it is again. Chiefly dial. Chiefly dial, dial press, dialect. I go, Lord, please, you're not helping me out here. You're making me scared. I don't want to, I can't believe, am I losing my mind? Heiress, heirloom, more at loom. I go to loom. It tells me it's a frame or a machine for the interlacing at right angles of the sets of threads or yarn, like keeping the fabric of society at odds, at right angles with our framing them to manipulate. I thought, oh man, maybe I'm just going crazy. Lord, can you help me out here? Here is hell. I was led there. And I said, Lord, just give me one more. I said, I'm just going to do one more. I said, please let me know if I am losing my mind, projecting my blind bias, or whether this is really real. And the next one that I went to, I went 13, 14, I went to 15th century, and there I read, Lord of Misrule. And I went, what? I never heard of that. Have you ever heard of Lord of Misrule? That's in Webster's. It's defined as a master, quote, a master of Christmas. Revels in England, especially in the 15th and 16th century. That's King James and his boys. That's their period. The master of Christmas, Christmas, of course, you know, most of you at least know, is a pagan holiday. Thank you, God, I said. I got it. But I was stunned for 3 days. Then chapter 9 goes into the truth about the fungus among us. And herein we advance the most likely thesis on the true origins of mad cow disease and its transmission to humans. Now, of course, what's called transmissible spongiform encephalopathies, they're called TSEs, they include mad cow disease in humans, scrapie in sheep, they include Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease in humans, and of course the government of the United States says that very few people are suffering with Creutzfeldt-Jakob. Well, you know what? They're lying. According to a recent Yale study, 13% of Alzheimer's patients have actually been misdiagnosed. You know how many Alzheimer's patients there are in the United States today? Well over 2.5 million. That means there currently is likely, according to a Yale study, well over 250,000, a quarter of a million people suffering in the United States today with mad cow disease of humans, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Again, you don't hear one word about that. Isn't that a little strange? And now we look at the most likely transmission theory, and centered in it is contaminated grains. Bad news for the vegans, for the vegetarians, because what we show you is that not only according to University of Chicago affiliated Howard Hughes Medical Research Institute, the prion crystals that they found were associated with yeast, which is a fungus. Fungus largely typically grows in grains. And that now you begin to wonder. When they told us that it was the mad cow disease in Europe, look over here, mad cow, mad cow, mad cow, think cow, think cow, think beef, think beef, think beef. All the media, including Oprah Winfrey, was full of the beef. And how did they say the beef got contaminated? It was through the contaminated feed that contained sheep brain. And those of us who remember that cows are vegetarians, they're herbivores, they're not carnivores, we thought, what are they eating meat for? But we were told that that was put in the feed. And we said, oh, okay, but that still didn't explain the fact that you had the wild animals all over the United States, particularly in the Northwest, the Midwest, the Southwest, you had wild elk, wild mule deer breaking out with transmissible spongiform encephalopathy. Mad elk disease. Mad deers. They weren't eating domestic feed. They were eating grains. Most likely fungal infected grains. And so in this chapter, we go into all of the evidence. There's a lot of scientific evidence and a mass of circumstantial evidence that screams that this is a far more likely theory of the transmission of what we now see in epidemic proportions as Alzheimer's and Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease in humans. When you place the contaminated feed in the center of this theory, you understand now why there have been some vegetarians, vegans, who have never touched beef in years and years, why they got Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Why you've got these things like whirling fish disease that may be related, besides the contaminated swine, thank you, Tyson Foods, good friend of Bill Clinton, for spreading the contaminated swine fertilizers that ran into the rivers and streams. Infected poultry included. These are the things that you will learn with regard to mad cow disease in Healing Codes in the last few chapters. Now, chapter 10 goes on. Once you understand that now virtually all of us have eaten of Babylon's harvest, we have all virtually consumed these fungal-infected grains that likely contain the mad cow disease protein prion crystal. Crystals are what? Electromagnetic receivers and transmitters. So much like they told you, look over here, it's mad cow, mad cow, mad cow, and you didn't consider grain. Look over here, they tell you, look at the biochips. Look at the mark of the beast. Look at the biochips that are likely, they say, particularly if you read the fundamentalist right-wing patriot groups and the other groups that are involved in kind of like the same type of work, in fact, that I am. They say that the biochips are being implanted, and even some of your own mainstream media is telling you the same thing. We show you that in the book. The biochips are going to be implanted for human surveillance and control through the vaccines, we're told, but all that involves biochip. You're never once told to look at the prion crystals that very likely are growing in a massive, if not the majority of Americans' brains today. And why do prions go to the brain? Because they're electromagnetic receivers and transmitters. That's what the brain is. It's the neurological functioning station, the center of electromagnetic neurological transmission reception. So that's apparently why it goes up there. And according to theorists, Jacques Benveniste, one of the world's leading experts from France, I met with him. He said even before I told him about this thesis and wrote about it, he had written a letter to the French government officials from public health saying that what he believes is the source of the prion crystal transforming from a normal form in the brain to an abnormal form, which then acts and grows like a crystal. One crystal seeds another crystal, creating brain holes and dementia. He said, most likely it's an electromagnetic signal that they're receiving from the environment. So in chapter 10, we go into the frequency vibrations and the biological apocalypse. And in here, we review the work, the brilliant work of Royal Raymond Rife and the energy healing machines based on the brilliant work of Nikola Tesla. We show you documents communique between J. Edgar Hoover, in fact, and Royal Raymond Rife. And Tesla's research, in fact, I downloaded about 65 pages from the internet on an FBI file, declassified. They probably kept 6,500 pages classified. They released 65 pages. Brilliant research on energy. And then I show you some horrific documents where I suddenly take what you now think, and many of you critical listeners to this video and you in the audience might think that this is an implausible theory that we're advancing, that the government would use things like Project HARP, I'll get to in a minute, and the electromagnetic frequency transmitters to manipulate prion crystal chips in the brain to bring on diseases, that would be too far-fetched for you to believe. Well, let me show you some U.S. government documents. In fact, even declassified documents. And suddenly you will realize this is not so far-fetched. Here is the summary of major events and problems of the United States Army Chemical Corps from 19 fiscal years 61 through 62. Notice it said secret at one point. Now it's no longer secret. They let it out. But here they'll get what they're interested in investigating under MK Ultra, the mind control and population control program. This is the mind control and depopulation program. Look, sound. Sound. What use can be made of sound for bluebird application? Consider ultrasonics, UHF, vibrations, monotonous sounds, and concussion. And on the same page, fungus. Use of fungus, bacteria, plant cultures, and poisons of various types. And then a little ways down from this, here you see, quote, research was resumed during fiscal year 61 and 62 period on botulinum toxin, substance responsible for botulism, and the research project on the crystalline toxin. The crystalline toxin that was responsible for CRDL. But some of the work was done in the biological laboratories acting as subcontractors like Litton Bionetics. So we show you some horrific documents that relate to the U.S. military intelligence's electromagnetic mind control projects. Project Moonstruck, Bluebird, Orion, Dreamland, Delta, Phoenix, the Montauk Project, Trident, and those are the major ones. And we show you, again, that the Chladni figures, the effects of sound on matter, relate to the effects of sound as emanated through prions as biochips. Again, here's my daughter Elena, and we show you this photograph to show you that the crystal technology, again, is associated with the biochip technology. So here is the biochips that, in fact, you read in your agricultural reports. Most farmers are, in fact, currently using these biochips injected into the stock to track where the cattle go. Prisoners now are being injected with these. Even in Denver, civilian populations are being injected with these for additional studies. And we go into this technology. Now, you know what's a revelation? Guess who the primary manufacturer of these biochips are? Try Howard Hughes, his group. Excuse me, are you trying to tell me that the pioneering investigators in protein prion crystals is the same as the pioneering inventors and manufacturers of the crystal biochips? Yes. And further than that, you'll see in a minute, Project IceCat, which is the international electromagnetic, primarily focused in Europe, the ionospheric heaters, that Project HARP is in Alaska, that these electromagnetic frequency transmitters, they put in out specific frequencies. And you see, but the problem is, and the potential is based on early Russian studies. Give you an example. The power to create disease and death from this technology was well investigated by Russians way back. For example, they took a culture dish full of cancer viruses and cancer cells. And it was closed in glass, and they stuck it next to another closed glass culture containing normal, healthy cells. And they shined an ultraviolet light through the cancer cells and the cancer viruses into the healthy cell culture, and guess what happened? No, nothing happened. Nothing happened. The healthy cell culture remained healthy. But as soon as they put a quartz crystal in between the two, did the same experiment again, you had spontaneous generation of cancer viruses and cancer cells in that previously sterile healthy culture dish. Again, it goes back to the picture I showed you of Elena. Spontaneous generation from sound, from frequency, from electromagnetics. So we show you that the Project IceCat in Europe and HARP, which are interrelated. In fact, they're so interrelated that they're mentioned on the same page on the website of the fourth European heating seminar of Project IceCat on the internet. And guess what? See, for example, here you see U.S. heater plans with Project HARP. Welcome to IceCat. See, they're interconnected. And more importantly, guess who holds the copyright on this material? None other than copyright 1994 by Cold Springs Harbor Laboratory, New York. Funded by Rockefellers, funded by Alfred P. Sloan, the home of the Human Genome Project, the home of world genocide. I think I told you before, at least in my previous works, you know, after Hitler, when eugenics got a bad name, they needed to change the name. What did they call it? The Human Genome Project. And there in those labs, I told you previously in other works that in those labs, by identifying the entire human genome, all the gene sequences, they were then able to determine which genes were associated with predispositions for diseases and which races. And that's suddenly, over the last few years, why you've been reading in the newspapers, gene for breast cancer in Jewish women discovered. Gene for sickle cell anemia in black men discovered. Gene for Ebola infection in black men or black people discovered. And then when I saw this, that's the end. Gene, I saw this on the headlines. Gene for sarcoma cancer development in Jewish men of European descent discovered. Isn't it interesting how frequently genes for Jews and genes for blacks discovered? Now you'll understand even more why in a couple minutes. But you see, this is Cold Springs Harbor Lab. The new name for eugenics, genocide, is the Human Genome Project. And this is who owns the patent on IceCat and HARP, the electromagnetic receivers and transmitters. Now I'm going to share with you the details from the report from Iron Mountain. That just like the protocols of the Elders of Sion, government officials said is a hoax. Don't read it. It's a hoax. It's supposed to be a fun thing. Somebody put it together as a comic thing. When you read it, And we have reprinted in black and white the entire summary section of that report for you to judge for yourself. In fact, there is nothing funny about it. Nothing. And more importantly, what it tells you in there is exactly what is happening to this planet and our civilization today. In the report from Iron Mountain, published by the Dial Press, they had 6 specific recommendations. When all was said and done in their analysis, here's what they recommended. And you tell me if this is not happening in our world today. Number 1, a giant, quote, open-ended space program, where they talked about how you could just put more and more money into it for the sake of maintaining the economics in post-military warfare era, so that they could also use this for space surveillance of the population. And along with that, quote, massive global environmental pollution and global warming. Why? Why would they do this? They explain it in the report from Iron Mountain. They explain, you see, that in a post-war era, when we have one world government on tap, what we need to do is take down the international boundaries and bring all the peoples of the world together. And the only way to do that, says Satan and his forces, is not by promoting love, but by promoting fear of a common threat. And the common threat, first one, is pollution. Everybody in the world is being affected by pollution and global warming, so that's going to bring the world together, and isn't that exactly what is happening legislatively? Recommendation number 4 is, quote, an established and recognized extraterrestrial menace, end quote. The alien phenomenon, of course, makes complete sense. Why, you can't even go into a toy store today without seeing alien creatures everywhere. For what? To instill fear that there is this external menace that will affect the entire world. They've even produced movies to that effect. You've seen that. A comprehensive, quote, a comprehensive social control program as a modern, sophisticated form of slavery. That was the recommendation number 5. So that they could enslave humanity without humanity knowing that they were being enslaved or enslaved and manipulated. Isn't that exactly what's going on today? And then finally, what we talked about earlier, direct eugenic management, quote, unquote. L.C. Lewin, 1967, Dial Press. Here's the piece de resistance. As I was looking through Wall Street Journal one day, February 26, 1999, here you see Howard Hughes Electronics seeks to restore satellite luster. And you read this, and it goes on to tell you that General Motors Corporation, that the Hughes Corporation is separately traded unit of General Motors. Who's General Motors? I exposed them royally in the book Emerging Viruses, AIDS, and Ebola. Alfred P. Sloan, chairman, director, president of General Motors. Sloan Cancer Kettering Memorial, Rockefeller partner, creators of the cancer industry, creators of the first chemotherapeutic, a derivative of mustard gas. That's who is behind Hughes. And what did they just do, according to this report? Well, they launched, in 1999, a bigger and more robust generation of satellites, dubbed the 702 line, featuring nearly twice the signal strength and communications capacity of current models. 7 plus 2 is 9. That's completion in 1999 for the New World Order, for the surveillance, for the technology, from the satellites above that interrelate to Project HARP and ICECAT, the electronic magnetic receivers and transmitters, to the biochips injected into your skin, to the prion crystals in your brains. You can thank Howard Hughes, the Sloans, the Rockefellers, and the Illuminati for it all. So chapter 12 leaves you ultimately considering MKUltra, the mind and population control program, and the mark of the beast. And it gives you some horrific revelations. Again, for example, right out of Webster's dictionary, when you look up dial, you see it says, more at deity. Yes, it is bizarre, isn't it, ladies and gentlemen? More at deity. 15th century, there's a 15th century code. We'll follow that a little bit down later. But talks about the face and sundial and the operations of telephone. And then here, dial. To manipulate a device as a dial so as to operate, regulate, or select. Isn't that what you're being done to today? Operated, regulated, and selected for death in many cases. And of course, deity, you know what that means. Deus, God, 14th century code, pertaining to the supreme being, one exalted or severely, supremely good or powerful. That's your dial press. Of course, 15th century code relates to deject, archaic, dejected, dejected, throw down, more a jet to make gloomy. We kind of talk about the chemtrails and the contrails that make our skies gloomy and how it relates to the toxification of the masses today. Delate, to bring down delicacy, the delegates. And then finally, you get to 15th century code at the bottom, and it says, deal, Scottish devil. The Scottish Freemason, the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, the devil and the deity, claiming to be the deity. Now, what I'm about to show you is a series of slides that come directly from Denver Airport today. Put them in your memory, because this is a graphic depiction of the ongoing genocide that's occurring today. You see, you have certain pacts as loving human beings with God, don't you? These people do not serve the God that you have pacts with. They serve an alternative deity, a Luciferian deity. And they have certain rituals and certain pacts that they must, observances that they must follow, otherwise they get into trouble. One of those is that they must put out to the general enslaved sheeple, the masses, exactly what they're doing in a manner that they won't really know. So they publish the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, and they tell you it's a comic document, an anti-Semitic document. Don't read it, but here it is. And then they give you the Iron Mountain Report, and they tell you, here's all the what we're doing, but it's all a comic thing. It just never really escaped by accident. Don't even bother with it. And they give you the fictional novels and the fiction from Hollywood that reflects so much of the truth, so that when somebody like me comes around who gives you the real facts, most of the masses, the brainwashed, mind-controlled slaves, sheeple, what they go is, that's just foolish conspiracy nonsense. The guy's been watching too much of Hollywood. So in Denver Airport today, as you go to the main baggage terminal, the only main terminal where you get your baggage, there is a series of murals there where the Illuminati have placed right before your eyes exactly everything that I've just told you. To kind of like go, ha ha, they're so stupid they don't even see it. So here you have your Nazi alien. Nazi alien. In the background, as the Nazi alien spears the dove of peace with his lance against the backdrop of horrific death and despair, primarily of who the black and Hispanic races were, the dead children who got vaccines. Depicted right in front of your eyes is the genocide. Here is the Nazi. You could sharpen that just a little bit, you would see. Here on his helmet is the skulls. And then, please sharpen that a little bit. Here, directly across the floor, in the main terminal building, which I'll show you, is a tribute to the Illuminati, a tribute to the Freemasons, virtually a temple. That here is a depiction and a dedication to the extinct species. Against a horrific backdrop of flames and fire and destruction, you see the extinct species. You see the despair on the faces of the children. And you see the buffalo, and you see the sea turtle and the whale. And in the foreground, you see three open caskets. Now, don't you? In the left one, you have a beautiful black African woman dressed in her native attire, representing the black people in Africa and the world. In the middle, you have the Native American woman. Again, reflect on what I said about the sterility of the Native Americans and the black women in America today. And for all those of you white middle-class people who are sitting there thinking that you're so safe, here you are. Here you are, in the right, a beautiful blonde-haired, probably blue-eyed woman, lying on an American quilt. Dead, clutching to her heart the Star of David. Here are the Jews, and here are the Christians. And between them is the Rosicrucians, the symbol, one of several, of the Illuminati. Why is the Christian and the Jew the same in one basket? I told you earlier. The first covenant was given to the Jews by God as the chosen. The second covenant, the covenant of blood, was given to the Christians, who are, in fact, the Jews, the ultimate remnant of the Hebrews. That's why they lie together in this casket in the tribute to the extinct species, because the forces against whom we do spiritual battle do not appreciate God's given us that covenant, those covenants. Here you are, American Jews and Christians. Take a good look. And here's the resolution. Here is the tribute to the New World Order. Notice, these are all children. There's no adults. That's why they've gone for the children's minds. That's why they created the children's rights agenda. That's why they broke their families down, created the issues with child abuse, so that they could steal the minds and the bodies of the children. That's why they're injecting the children with the vaccines. Here are the children that remain. Here's the dead Nazi alien now in the New World Order. And look at who is at the foreground of all the children. Why, the Deutsche Bursch, don't you know, the German boy. There he is, banging his anvil. The German boy. There he is. And here is the final resolution. As we all sit around in the New World Order, just the children, mind you, again, the youth, around a lotus blossom, practicing one world religion. There's a dance going on here, and music. And the dance, if you look at the left-hand side of the screen, is being led by one character, who is the dominant character in this picture. He is the Scottish Rite Freemason, adorned with all his symbolism, next to the Deutsche Mann, the German boy. There he is, symbolic of the Freemasons and New World Order. This is the capstone, the dedication stone in that particular temple of the Freemasons in Denver Airport. Notice this capstone reads, Denver International Airport, dedicated March 19, 1994, for the New World Airport Commission. Here is the Masonic symbol in the middle, dedicated and laid by the most worshipful Grand Lodge ANFMM Benjamin H. Bell Jr. Grand Master. Now, excuse me, is that pagan? I thought we were supposed to only pay tribute and bow our knees to one God. The most worshipful is God. Here's the Claude W. Gray Senior Grand Master, who also joins the most worshipful in the Masonic Order. And then here, again, is the symbolism of the mallet that the German fellow is wielding. And in between, now get this, as you go from the Nazi alien mural to the extinct species mural, virtually directly in the middle, this is the symbol that's in the floor. And next to this symbol is this symbol, AUAG, which stands for silver and gold, which has spiritual more than physical value properties. But you know what? Guess what you will see when you review that list of toxic biological and infectious agents that Bionetics Research Lab submitted to the National Cancer Institute? You won't see hepatitis B. Hepatitis B was the vaccine that triggered the international AIDS pandemic. But you will not see hepatitis B as the source on that list. You know what you will see? The original term for hepatitis B was the Australian antigen. What you had on the list was AUAG, the source of genocide. So here are some additional symbols that you will see as you walk through Denver Airport today. Gargoyles, reminiscent of the ancient times. Here you see reptiles, reptilians in the floor. And I might take this opportunity to just comment briefly on the work of David Icke, because a lot of people asked me about David Icke's work, because what David Icke had proposed in his most recent book, The Biggest Secret, and I totally respect David Icke as a very legitimate researcher in the field of exposing the Illuminati. But in his new work called The Biggest Secret, I think he goes a little bit too far, at least what I'm comfortable with, in his condemnation of all the religions. In essence, what he's done is he throws the baby out with the bathwater and condemning all of the religions, and literally says that all of the religions are based on myths. It is a complete hoax, everything. Now, basically, from my understanding and appreciation of Scripture and the Ten Commandments, there is nothing inherently wrong with those laws. More importantly, when David Icke said in his new book that it's such a myth that evidence indicates that Christ never existed. Moses, he said, never existed. Now, excuse me, I find problem with that. Here's my particular problem. Number one, you see, my Hebrew name is Aryeh ben Shlomo Halevi. Translated, that means Lion of God, Son of Solomon, the Levi. And in fact, my mother gave me that name proudly when I was about 8 years old. She told me that that was my name as she delivered to me my talis and my yarmulke and my scriptures to study for my bar mitzvah. She says, you should be very proud because here is your Hebrew name. You are of royal blood. Now, you tell that to an 8-year-old who is living in virtually an urban ghetto, and it goes in one ear and out the other. But she explained. She says, your father is also Ben Shlomo, son of Solomon, Halevi. Levites were the ancient Levi priests. and that his father was son of Solomon, his father was son of Solomon, and it goes all the way back, she explained to me, to King Solomon. So that means for me, for David Icke's theory to be correct, I would have to deny the Davidian bloodline. David never existed, Solomon never existed, Christ never existed, and I never existed. Now I know I exist. So I think I'm living proof that David Icke's thesis is wrong in that way. David Icke also says that the reptilian races, the aliens, are really behind what's happening on this planet. The problem I have with that if you are the Illuminati, how you manipulate, how Satan manipulates, how the evil forces, dark forces of this universe manipulate is through fear. And what better entity would you use than reptiles to manipulate human beings to become afraid than reptiles? That seems to be from the snake in the Garden of Eden to current day dinosaurs. We are afraid of those things. I just am very suspicious. There's no question in my mind that there may be aliens. It is logical to assume there are aliens. I am certain that there is fallen angels who do very evil things. And I am certain that there are God's forces and wonderful angelic beings, because I am nurtured and supported by those, thanks to tens of thousands of people like yourselves who pray for my family and I. But the fact of the matter is, I can't buy that the reptile aliens are the ones who are pulling the political strings of the Illuminati. It's just too convenient. Now, in the final 100 pages of the Healing Codes book, you will find some extraordinary information. In fact, it should be a book in and of itself. It's called the Appendix Section. And in the Appendix Section, we show you some extraordinary things. We also go into a fellow by the name of Lawrence Gardner, who, like David Icke, said that Christ, although he existed, he didn't really die on the cross. He extended his Davidian bloodline. And so what we show you is some very interesting information. This is a computer printout that was done by a software program, an astronomical software program designed for use by NASA scientists. And this is the view from Bethlehem on September 15th, 5 BC. And if you look 15 degrees up from the sky from Bethlehem, you see that Venus and Regulus are directly in line with a couple other major planets, creating the illusion of a huge, bright star, what may have been and likely was the star of Bethlehem. Now, notice what happened, and this is really real. When the computer printed this, notice it made a mistake in the printing of the word Bethlehem. Notice it put a star asterisk instead of the B. It never made that mistake before, and it never made it again. And that when we did a search, 10,000 years before this and 10,000 years after this date, the only time there was anything similar to this was on March 28, 28 AD, when Christ is believed to have died and risen. That here you see the same virtual alignment of Regulus and Venus, Regulus being the little king, Venus the god of love. The god of love brought together to amalgamate, like Regulus is, the impure masses. Isn't that indeed what Christ's mission here was all about? A mission of love, divine love. So we show you that most likely that Lawrence Gardner, who advances the thesis that Christ did not die on the cross, was wrong. He was wrong. And that we show you his connections to the 33-degree masonry, and the royal families who have access to the church materials that are kept from the other masses. Well, that brings us to the conclusion. Where does that leave you? Where does that leave me? Well, it leaves us exactly where we need to be left. Think about it. The end of the book, you realize that there's no really good way to prepare for this type of bio-spiritual warfare except one. In other words, there's a lot of people going out and buying a lot of food supplies for Y2K and the new millennium. And there's a lot of people who are buying properties up in northern Idaho and elsewhere, survivalist homesteads, and they're putting in their power generators and they're buying gold and they're putting that under their houses and they're doing all these things. But you know what? Where this book leaves you is realizing that in the wake and in the face of this bio-spiritual warfare technology, if you don't have your relationship right with God, you are nowhere. Nowhere. And really, that's the message, isn't it? We started tonight with a quote from 1 Corinthians, where it was all about the edification of the congregation. The evangelistic theme of raising up the masses' knowledge, creating from mankind, Godkind. Godkind, being kind to God. And that's truly where you are left, realizing that no matter what you do, in order to overcome the powerful spiritual energies that Project HARP and IceCat and the Illuminati are wielding, there's only one superior force to that in this universe, and that is God. So in essence, this is a great celebration, because what I've done over the last, let's say, 3 hours, 3.5 hours, is show you documented evidence from the Illuminati's own works that the only place to go at this end time scenario is back to God. Hallelujah. Now, let me tell you a little bit more. You see, every single one of you are here tonight or listening to this video because you want to put more pieces of this extraordinary puzzle together to enable you to live healthier and happier, ultimately, ever after. And that really, what part of you longs for is the knowledge of what your role, what your special purpose in life is really about. I'm going to, in a minute, tell you a story that deals with this from my grandfather. And that the purpose in life that you express during this end times is, along with your relationship with God, critical in keeping you vital and alive. And you'll see that in a minute when I relay the story to you. But I want you to know that this game is over. That literally Satan has lost his lease on this planet. And that the fat lady is about to sing as we enter the Messianic Age, because that is our destiny. And no one, nothing, nobody can stop it. For me, this has been a process of, in fact, fulfilling my destiny. That's why I went from Massachusetts to northern Idaho. That's why I got this material. Because when I reflected on chapter 3, when I was reviewing the book Healing Codes, as now an editor would, and read my own work, and I suddenly had a flashback to the time I just told you about when my mother presented me with my talis and yarmulke and my scriptures for my lessons, and she told me that I was of the Davidian bloodline, of Solomon's bloodline? You see, what I reflected on was how perfect this is for me. Because as Aryeh ben Shlomo, son of Solomon the Levi, I reflected back that who was it that first buried these codes from the masses but my own ancestors from the Levi tribe, the high priests? And then who was it that stole from my own ancestors King Solomon's temple in the Holy Land, the same ancient arcana, but the Templars and King James and his boys? So I realized, for me, this was a fulfillment of destiny, that I would be so selectively chosen and blessed to deliver back to the loving masses that which first was hidden by my ancestors and then stolen from my ancestors. That it's perfect for me. Now, just like that, the evolution that is going on within you in you fulfilling your spiritual purpose in life is like a locomotive on one-way track going right into the Messianic Age. Nobody, nothing can stop that as you make your way, and you are going to be totally, incredibly blessed with God's Spirit coming in and pouring in through you like you never in your wildest, wonderful dreams ever imagined. That is our destiny together, brothers and sisters. Finally, let me end with a story of how it is you should not be afraid. As King Solomon was counseled by David to build the temples of God, today you need to, like Solomon did, have no fear in preparing for the plagues, in preparing for all this. Again, I've used this talk time and time again. It is such an important story. It is the most powerful story I can tell you. It is a true story of my grandfather, how I learned about the power of spirituality, connection to God, and fulfilling your purpose in life, your divinity, your gift, to your longevity and your health. My grandfather died at age 93. He died because it was his time. Here's how it happened. First, I'll give you some background about my granddad. First of all, he was a chain smoker. He smoked unfiltered Camel cigarettes for over 75 years in a way that you can't imagine anybody smoking those short cancer sticks. And he did that for over 75 years. In other words, he would cut them into thirds. He would therefore only smoke the hottest, most tar and nicotine-ridden portion of the cigarette every puff, and that didn't kill him. The greatest love of my grandfather's life, more background, was his wife Betty, who he loved and cared and doted over. And above all, the greatest love of all was God. And as a young man, I would visit them in Atlantic City, New Jersey, and I would be stunned as I watched three times a day for 3 hours a day my grandfather praying and giving thanks to God. He would bind his wrists and palms with the scriptures and do the same thing over his forehead and put on his shoulders the prayer shawl and the yarmulke on his head. And there I would watch him davening, giving thanks in deep, tranced meditation and giving praise to God for all of his glorious blessings in his life. And this man was as poor as a church mouse, but he felt that he was so blessed with Betty and the little things that they had. He was so grateful. That's what he did. Now, what happened was, with his death, what brought his death on, it was around Christmas time in Atlantic City that year, Hanukkah time. It was icy and cold on the streets. My grandmother and grandfather went out for a walk, and my grandmother fell down and broke her hip. So they rushed her to the hospital. The doctors pieced her together. They called in my father from Philadelphia. I came along. We met my uncle there, and the doctors talked to my father and my uncle, and they said, you've got to put Betty and Morris into a nursing home because your dad, God love him, can't take care of Betty anymore. She needs some intensive care. And so they told that to my grandfather, and he said, if you do this, I will die. And they thought about it for a couple days, and they said, well, Dad, you know, it doesn't seem like there's any other options. You can't carry a oxygen tanks up two flights of stairs. How are you going to do that? And he said, if you do this, I will die. So they went for another week or two. They talked about it behind his back. And now my father and my uncle both were not wealthy, but they figured that their grandparents, 93 and Betty was like 91, they didn't have much longer to live, so they weren't going to spare the expense. They were going to find the most beautiful nursing home that they could find, and they were going to just surprise my grandfather with that. So they did it. They went to him, and they said, "Dad, first of all, we don't want to talk about you dying. That's ridiculous. Don't even think about it. But we found this place we just want to have you take a look at. It's only 2 blocks from where you live now. We've talked to the nurses there. They're kind and wonderful. They're going to let you take care of Mom as much as you want. And it's right on the boardwalk. You can get exercise every day and breathe fresh air. And they have a temple, a shul there. You can pray with people your own age. Won't you at least come take a look?" And he told them, "No! If you do this, I will die!" Well, they did it. 2.5 weeks later, the man was cold stone dead. And he died so fast, even the doctors wanted to know what he died from. So they ordered the autopsy. And there I stood, literally 4 feet from my father, when the surgeon came up from the morgue, and he said, quote, "Mr. Horowitz, for the life of me, I can't understand how your dad could have lived for the last 20 years. Every single bone, muscle, and organ throughout his entire body was riddled with cancer." You see, what kept that man alive all those years were those two things: his devout divine connection to God and the fulfillment of the purpose in life to care and share with another human being in a meaningful way. If you have those two things in your life, I guarantee you, there won't be a Project Harp. There won't be a prion crystal. There won't be a Rothschild or a Rockefeller or a Henry Kissinger that are going to kill you before your time. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.